Hello, one and all, for another week of AUDL action. Dan Hilton and Tony Leonardo here today. Thanks for joining us in the pit on Randall's Island, or Field 10, as the New York locals call it. The Empire 3-5, hosting the Ottawa Outlaws 2-6 on the season. Both these teams have had their ups and downs, certainly this year, with the Empire still mathematically capable of making the postseason, as they have not missed any time in their history. Ottawa, meanwhile, will have to have a lot go right, not yet mathematically eliminated, but again, a lot will have to happen in the Outlaws' favor with a record of 2-6. They basically have to win out and hope a lot of things happen, including the Empire and the Montreal Royal, to not have much success either home or away. For Ottawa, the big storyline coming into today is that they are missing quite a few pieces, as Tony, now you can attest to this, with the World Beach Championships going on in France right now, that has led to the Outlaw roster being pretty depleted.
Yeah, well, they pulled a lot of folks over to Royan. It's a great showcase event for the sport, of course. They are trying to show off for the Olympic Committee, because the Olympics may be in Paris in 2024. And it might be on the beach surface as opposed to grass. So 7 players from the Outlaws are currently there in various divisions, including their leading scorer, Halter. Is that right? Derek Alexander, another one of their key players, not at Beach World or here. But 7 players missing from the Outlaws to enjoy the time in France on the beach. And that just wrapped up today, actually. Today was the final games. The USA almost had a complete sweep. The USA women lost to the Russian women in the gold medal match, 11-10.
And there were some scares there for the U.S. side of things as far as the U.S. taking on Spain. Spain had taken that early lead, and it was probably one of the games of the tournament when the U.S. basically came storming back against their, well, not to say Spanish rivals again. As far as Beach Worlds goes, you don't play too often.
Well, I'll say this. So I played in Beach Worlds in 2011 on the USA team for Masters, and we lost a pool play game to Austria, and that was absolutely the best thing that could have happened to us. So losing a game that isn't going to affect where you're going to land when it goes on can be a very beneficial thing, and I feel like that, you know, even a close game like that may have actually helped the United States. And on the Canadian side, of course, if I'm trying to remember this correctly, I think the men's Canadian team was also in the finals, and most of their squads were in the semis or the finals. So we'll have to find out exactly which teams made it where for those, and find out where these guys landed, because again, the elite squads coming from the United States and Canada, as typically the case.
Well, speaking of winning and losing, one of the main storylines we talked about, Ottawa's, as far as can they win this kind of game with a depleted roster. But the storyline for the Empire is, can they win this game? Because, again, not to say it's a must-win game, because every game for the last few weeks has been must-win if the Empire want to get back to the postseason. But this one in particular, as we wind down, only a few weeks left of the season, they know they have to take care of business with 3 of their final 6 games against the Outlaws. So they're basically going to have to get a clean 3-game sweep of Ottawa, both home and away. Is this also being the final home game of the season for the Empire? So, I mean, Tony, you don't want to use the cliche of must win, but this is about as must win as it can get for the Empire.
At this point, they're all must win for the Empire. If they want to make the playoffs, they have to win out. They can lose 1 game, is what CJ told me a couple weeks ago, and they have Toronto on the roster in Toronto.
Right.
So, but even if they lose that 1 game, they have a very good chance of missing the playoffs. So it's win or go home from here on out. So that's definitely the case for this team that was picked early on to be one of the contenders in the East, the New York Empire. And, you know, you see what they have out there. The talent is extraordinary, and they just haven't been able to, you know, beat D.C. When you're going to come down to it, they lost 3 games to D.C., and that could be the end of the season for them. We'll find out.
Well, one of the questions we asked the head coach and CJ Ouellette of the Empire is getting Ben Yacht involved in the offense. And, well, he plays on the defensive line, of course, with Jeff Babbitt. But, you know, not having Ben Yacht due to the college season, of course, you know, being in college, it kind of deprived the AUDL fans of getting to see a whole season of Babbitt and Yacht.
Although, talk to Minnesota Winchell, I'm sure
of course,
Lewis and Abramowski and those guys would have loved to have Ben stay in Minnesota.
Right.
But Ben is here now with us, and we'll take him. He has been all that's been advertised, really, just a monster. Saw him here last week, just really cleaning up anything in the air. And with Babin on one side, Yad on the other, just watch out if you're going to try to throw it deep. So the question for, you know, and they know this, Ottawa knows this. So what are they going to try to do is they're going to try to work it up. You know, they're not going to test. You don't want to test those guys deep. And Ryan Dross is not even talked about. The league leader in blocks last year is also on that same D-line. So it's going to be a real interesting test for a team like Ottawa and for the rest of the games this season for the Empire is how are people going to solve that kind of ferocious defense. You have no rejoinder to that, huh, Dan?
Well,
we have no
commercials.
If you're concerned about going commercial, we can I can play something off my phone if you would like.
No, it's all right. Well, I would say as far as Ottawa's game plan is, there's a slight breeze, but as we had even spoken to, but the player coach in Nick Boucher, who's, you know, he has had a number of Ds this year, 13 Ds. However, he plays on the O-line. Just because, again, when they're at full strength, he plays a number of points on the D line. But now, again, due to the lack of Kinley G, Alec Arsenault, who has 40 goals this year. They don't have 40 goals in just one player in Arsenault. He's as we mentioned at World Beaches. And as far as everybody else, Boucher being player coach, having to call your own lines, and to me, Tony, that seems like a whole lot to do while you're also again trying to go out there where you kind of have to switch on and off between different roles. And one of the co-captains, Eric Hunter, is going to be calling the defensive lines. And as far as injured players and players on reserves, they're going to be helping out calling lines and figuring out personnel as we go throughout the game. So for Ottawa, yes, you're depleted, and that has to do in terms of, you know, getting tired and having everybody be able to play for four quarters. But as far as organization goes and as far as where you are in your headspace, it's just, again, getting accustomed to having to play and coach and worry about all the tactical things on the side as well. I think that's even the biggest challenge for Ottawa other than just the physical part of it.
Well, yes and no, because as ultimate players, we've all done that.
Like, that's true.
Yeah. I mean, we're actually more used to being player coaches than we are being coached.
Right.
By someone. So historically, the sport is fine with having a player coach on the field, totally fine. The nuances of the game, however, and especially playing in the AUDL, do not lend favor to that. You know, every point counts, and so if you, you know, aren't there to, you know, strategically call your timeout, get the right personnel on the field, you know, it can add up. And in a game like this where you're going to need every point, it can be less beneficial to your team.
Right.
We'll listen real quick to the lineups, and we'll give you a break here.
Number 36, Matt Wiener. Number Number 80, Ryan Dross. Number 87, Jeff Babbitt. And number 88, Ben Yatt. Head coach, Joe Ouellette. Those are your New York Empire. We now will ask that our audience please stand and rise for the national anthem.
They heard it, the national anthems here in the pit, Field 10 on beautiful Randall's Island in New York City, as the Ottawa Outlaws have made the about 7.5-hour trip down from the Great North up in Canada. That's why, again, we were serenaded by both the Canadian national anthem and, of course, the Star Spangled Banner. As you heard us probably talk about pregame, and Dan Hilton and Tony Leonardo here for today's game and today's action in the East Division. These two teams meeting for the first time this year, and the Empire have their final home game of the regular season as well going on. So an interesting and diverse AUDL schedule this year. It depends on schedules, who can come down and who can come down when. Of course, in the East with those three teams up in Canada, in Montreal, Ottawa, and Toronto, some funky different two-day trips can occur for both the teams in D.C., Philadelphia, and New York going up there, and the three Canadian teams, we'll say, coming down here into the States. And for Ottawa, they've got New York today and the Philadelphia Phoenix tomorrow. And the lineup they have is missing a number of key players, as we had earlier talked about, due to the World Beach Championships going on in Royan, France. Including, we'll just go through who's missing before we spend this game talking about who's here. Of course, missing Alec Arsenault, 40 goals, 13 assists, 53 points, 7 Ds for him. Kinley G on the offense as well, 9 goals, 19 assists. Matt O'Brien, Paul Renaud, Dave Ochalter, Luca Milgaretto, and Dave Jansen all at World Beaches. But there's still plenty of talent, particularly on this O-line. And in particular, Tony, we're going to see the Ottawa D-line first, but once we get over the O-line, we're going to see Boucher, who's got 13 points, as in 4 goals, 9 assists, as well as, again, that big receiver with Essenall out in Andrew Ochterlony with
Ochterlony, for those in the States here, one of the legends of Canadian Ultimate on the East Coast. We talked to Coach Boucher before the game, player Coach Boucher before the game. We were like, is Andrew Ochterlony in the Hall of Fame? And he says, not yet. he's still playing. We, you know, have to wait a few more years before we they put him in there. One thing to note, too, we'll tell you, we're going to have to call out the scoreboard for you. We'll pan over to it every now and then, and Dan here will be keeping good track of that, so we'll get the score for you. As we pull from left to right, the Ottawa Outlaws pulling down to the New York Empire here. Again, every game important. Harper Garvey up to Sean Keegan. Keegan serving the field. He wants a quick cuck. He's got a man off the bat. It's Chris Kotcher. Can Kotcher get up in the air? This time again, it tips up in the air, and it's no good. Easily defended that disc, hung too much. And they flew Kotcher out there pretty quickly on a designed puck play, but unsuccessful.
We got to first look at that whirling wind, Tony, that both coaches did tell us that there is a slight breeze, and more than you'd think from up here.
McGregor gets in to get the play, and there's a little foul as Kotcher got him in the back. Jordan McGregor will walk it up. He's got in front of him Peter Lamarre, number 12. So this is the Ottawa D-line on the field right now. Colin Frotz in the middle. Let's see, he's looking for Frotz, actually. Frotz has got it. Frotz looking upfield. Let's see what their offense looks a little jumbled right now. He's trying to get the around, and he gets it, but it's dropped. An easy drop, a one hand, not needed to go up with one hand, but he does, and it's a turnover, and Harper Garvey will take it. Garvey will survey the field and drop it back down to Keegan. Keegan up high to Kotcher. Kotcher slings it into Mike Drost. He's the guy eating up space out there, and he slings it through the middle just barely, and he gets it to his man. Can't see the number from here, but that's a goal for Mike Drost.
And that looks like Connor Klein to me, the number 10.
Yeah.
And for Connor Klein, his 18th goal of the year, and as they're not necessarily designed plays, but Connor Klein, if you look at his stats, Tony, and you've seen it throughout the year, he just knows where how to get open in the end zone. And you have guys like that where if they don't necessarily make those long in cuts to get you 20 yards in the middle of the field, but he's always going to be wide open in the end zone. He's not necessarily particularly tall or particularly fast, but he's just always open because he's certainly taller than most and certainly quicker than most.
Timing is everything. We saw that last week. Matt Stevens was open just on pure timing. Matt Stevens is also very fast. Matt Stevens not playing today, however. A little tweak of the hamstring. They're going to rest him for today, save him for the big Canadian trip coming up. Big pull here down from New York. That is Harper Garvey pulling. What? No, it should have been Ryan Drost or Wodach even. Let's see what Ottawa can do with the disc on with their O-line. Looking to isolate Scott Westwell in the middle. Westwell's got it. Westwell. Drop it back. They want to be conservative here. You don't want to test this New York team deep as they get yacht under with Leon Forsnall. Forsnall will fake. Oh, that's a big D coming up for Drost, but he can't get to it. Instead, it's Jeremy Hill. Out wide. This one's going to pop up in the air, but should be an easy goal, and it is. Number 16, Laurent Rousseau catches the disc, and it's a tie game. 1-1, both offenses with holds.
That's his 15th of the year, and that's a matchup that I think we're going to watch as far as the defensive line of the Empire versus the offensive line. Scott Westwell, that's only his third assist of the season, but Westwell against Josh Aloro for me is going to be a good matchup if they continue to play that way. Though, again, head coach C.J. Gillette did tell us going into this one that defensively they like to switch up those matchups quite often. So, again, you can't really get too concerned with seeing 1 point and saying, oh, it's going to be Westwell versus the Laurel all day. But to me, Tony, that seems to be a little more exciting when you can stay with that same guy and those matchups continue. But, you know, strategically, defensively, switching it up works a lot better.
I mean, they're not going to do that. Like, they played mostly zone against Philadelphia, and there's no reason not to do that against Ottawa. So they definitely just put a wrinkle there by playing man just to see where it's at, see if those jitters would stay for Ottawa, but Ottawa held it. Now on offense. Back to Keegan, obviously their main center guy here. He slides it over to Klein. Klein again, this is a hybrid line here. Last week, Dan, talking to Coach Ouellette, this popped up in the air, but Drost, ooh, he just jumped up a little too early, and it's a turnover. Ottawa with a chance for a break. They get it up to McGregor. McGregor finds his guy. They're going to try to work through the middle. Now they're trying to find out where to work it. They're looking for Jeff Bavon over here on the side. they sling it up high to over Bavon, and instead this gets to Kyle Cantal. Cantal, a nice catch there from Westwell. He puts it under. It's a young team here. Oh, through the middle, nicely done. The I.O. break mark zipped through by Russ Nichols. That was well done by Nichols, as the defense was a little soft there for New York's O-line, and it's an early break for Ottawa.
The goal there by Khalid Al-Zahrani, his first goal of the year. And, you know, Tony, as far as guys breaking into it for Ottawa, with so many missing, while yes, the negative is they don't have their main guys, the positive is that you're going to see if Ottawa's depth can stay with it.
The depth is going to be a factor. I think, you know, this early break, it's, you know, it's a benefit to Ottawa, and it is going to be a question of whether this young sort of like threadbare line missing seven of their elite guys, if they're going to be able to keep it up.
Because again, if you see Al-Zahrani just getting his first goal, let's say Al-Zahrani ends the day with eight goals. That's what I mean. You show your depth, and you know, there are guys that we might not necessarily see because of the high quality talent that Ottawa usually can put out there.
Sam Little with the disc. Now, first half last week, Dan, when they played the Philadelphia Phoenix, this game was tied at the end of the first quarter, 7-7. So, big zip there from Sam Taylor, and it's caught by Connor Klein. Connor Klein goes up and Taylor Brooks put that disc, and Connor Klein shows his range and his versatility. We see him in the backfield, and we see him downfield going up. That's two goals already for Connor Klein, and this game is at two right now, but the break advantage to Ottawa.
Well, Tony, I did promise you that Connor Klein would be in the end zone, and there he was again.
Did you promise that?
Well, in the first goal. I told you he'd be open in the end
zone. You did say he'd be open in the end zone.
And there he was again, open again. And that's kind of what Taylor Brooks' game has been. This now his fifth season with the Empire, and he's been doing that for the last 5 years. Again, not necessarily one of your guys that is going to play again, not necessarily every point, but he's not going to be the main guy that Sean Keegan is. He's not going to be in the middle of your main middle handler. But Taylor Brooks has had consistency, and he's been there for the Empire every step of the way.
Well, he's part of the faceless mob. Now, there is a group of guys here that have been playing for the Empire for some time and nicknamed by Evan Lepler the faceless mob, and Brooks is one of them. You have to see Octoloni make anything huge here. Here's the disc handling through Ken Alexander. Alexander finds an opening. Now, here's the zone kind of as we expected from New York. Not too windy of a day. That might be. Here's Octoloni with a disc, actually. He drops it through the middle. That's to Boucher.
And here on this near side, number 18, you get a look at him, Leon Forrest-Nolt, 15 goals. I expect him to do a little bit more and get a little more involved as well. He's just kind of hanging out here on this far side.
Octoloni climbs the ladder, looking for the hammer. Again, without a wind, maybe the zone isn't going to be as effective. Sure going to find out. Drops it down to Westwell. Brooklyn. Ken Alexander with the disc. And he lefty scoobers it back. This is Leon Forrest-Nolt. Up to Boucher. Boucher slides it. They're being very patient. This is what you want to be. Alexander looking. Where are the holes in the zone? That's an easy one. Can they find more? Do they want to test somebody like Ben Yacht deep? Ben Yacht is hanging out back there. Alexander, he's been everywhere so far. And New York just hoping they make a mistake. Octoloni faking. Where's it going to be? Scoobers it back. It's a little far, but no problem. For Westwell. Ooh, that was almost a turnover as it stuck on his hand. But Westwell is there. That throw from Lozeau. Now, Dan, where do you look to crack the zone here now? This is a pretty decent effect job so far by New York.
Yeah, I think that swing right there, if you bring two cutters and you have to make sure you're splitting Wodach and Babbitt and find that space in between.
Yeah, you're right. They didn't. There's one through the middle. Risky throw. Octoloni with it after Wodach had slipped down. And now there's an opportunity here. Another hammer. That's going to work. And let's see, as Yacht kind of dropped back, will they go into man here? And that's Hill with the disc. The man is called. There's a quick break, and Yacht will get there. No, he won't. The line of sight not good for us here in the booth as Loiseau collects the goal. Nice patience there. A couple of iffy throws. Ottawa stays on it. So far, their O-line has been perfect.
Yeah, now with a 3-2 lead. And what I liked about that from Ottawa that time was doing exactly that. They basically clogged the Jeff Babbitt side of the field on the far sideline. And then when they were able to get one throw over the middle, they brought everybody on the weak side, if you will, and then they continued to try to split John Wodas. And that's no fault of Wodas, but they just, again, continued to have multiple receivers on this side of the field, worked it up, and then the goal wound up being on the opposite side of the field again with basically a cross field, I believe it was a backhand.
Yeah, you know, way to use the width of the field, as they say often.
Right.
And that is the way to do it, too. You find the hole, you get it to the weak side, to the break side, and then you run it up there because you're going to have a lot of openings.
And these players are so smart, too. When you first get that first look, immediately look for someone within your close 5-foot proximity and continue to get 10, 20 yards that way.
Quick pool play there as Keegan centers to Garvey, who finds Taylor Brooks coming out of the stack. Out of the side stack. Now it's Garvey over to Sam Little. Sam Little out of, I think I've said it every broadcast, Dan Hilton. He went to University of Georgia. Don't know what that means, but it's true. Big hammer from Garvey. He's got Mike Drost open. It's a goal. Beautiful upwind shot from Harper Garvey. Wow. He put a nice touch on that one. I thought his defender might be there with Drost, but it's hard to, you can't defend against that. Facing the wind, going up to that cross field side. Beautiful put there from Garvey.
And the East Division's kind of been put on notice this season for Harper Garvey. He came out as an unknown prospect, a guy coming from a small school in the Midwest at Knox College. But for Garvey, over the course of the year, in a lot of those losses early season on, Garvey would rack up a number of turnovers. And for the Empire, if Garvey can limit those turnovers, let's say get out of this whole game with just two or three, that's telling you that the New York Empire offense was finding those openings, finding those holes, and allowing Garvey to make those big-time throws. And that's what Garvey has. He has those big-time throws.
Yeah, and that's what it takes to get to the next level, where you make those throws and you don't make the turnovers. You know, it's a team game, so you can't just say that Garvey was out there making turnovers. It's everyone. You know,
right.
The whole offense wasn't in sync. And now we have a little bit of wind. You feel the wind pick up a little bit as the zone again from New York comes down. Let's see what Ottawa is going to do as they get it up to Alex Boucher, of course. Boucher.
And this is a different zone than we saw last time even, too, where Ryan Dross is much, much closer.
Yeah, they have a rabbit. So the guy who's marking right now is called the Rabbit. And I believe that is, who's number 18 out here? Tyler Haskell is the Rabbit for New York. And there's the turnover they wanted. So they forced a sling up the sideline and an easy turn as Wodach will pick it up here on the near sideline.
Yeah, that's always a difficult throw from Westwell, particularly with how good of an athlete Wodach is.
Wodach guarded by Jeremy Hill. Easy upfield to Sam Taylor. Sam Taylor looking for Babbitt, but Babbitt wasn't there. Up to Matt Lamar. Lamar trying to punch it in. He does through the middle. He got his man. Nice cut there. Nice setup. As
it is
Tyler
Haskell.
Yeah.
His third goal of the year. And Haskell did a good job. And for a lot of the younger players, and depending on our audience today, a lot of the younger players would notice that, you know, they say at the fundamentals, don't clog the lane. When you come to the open side, make sure you're not clogging the lane so another player can cut in that direction. But for Haskell, if, again, you've been playing long enough together and you understand, he just stayed there. His defender predicted that he would go back into the stack, but instead, Haskell stayed in the lane for a moment and just told Lamar, hey, I'm still wide open, and it made it an easy score.
Yeah, tried to sandwich the break side and the four side and left Haskell, another Georgia player, another Georgia guy in the middle there.
And former Hustle players as well.
Yeah, the ATL Hustle. We thought they'd be a little stronger this year, but, boy, that South Division has been monstrous. We knew when Jacksonville put the roster together, very scary.
Right.
And Jay Frode and Abe Coffin signed on with Dallas, very scary. And then we know what Raleigh's got going on. So
it's amazing to me that the Austin Soul are 2-8 with the talent they have. You know, you really do feel, I mean, you feel bad for the Nashville Nightwatch, 0-9, trying to get their first win. But in that division between Raleigh, Dallas,
happen.
Jacksonville, it's very difficult.
It's not going to happen. Yeah, they have very, it's going to be very difficult for them. So Octorlone looks through the middle with the hammer, and that breaks the zone open temporarily, but now it's reset again. And now they're into man. So that little hammer was enough to break the zone. Ottoloni slings it back to Westwell. Westwell through the middle. Some body contact. No call there. 74. Russ Nichols up to McGregor. McGregor looking. It's his man. Now they've got some speed behind them. Ottawa doesn't mind not having to go through the teeth of the zone here. And there's a whistle. Looks like it's going to be a downfield pick. That'll be 10 yards, and McGregor will walk it back. It's 4-3 right now. New York with the lead on serve. Ottawa. That looked like a clean D to me, but they're going to call that a foul. As maybe Aloro got him.
Actually, I think they called it on Yacht. Aloro was the one, I think, who thought he got the D.
Okay.
And then Yacht got a piece of the man.
Westwell. Through the middle. Ottoloni. Fakes the hammer. Double team here from Holmes. Gets it back. Up to Alexander. Holmes playing great defense here. Can he get up? Who's going to get this one? Holmes really just all over him. Forced his man to get up in the air. That was Westwell versus Holmes. And Holmes got him up in the air. Now it's a break and a run for the Empire. Drost. Wodach. Wodach fakes the huck. Oh, and he had Sam Little open. Sorry, Aloro. But it's good. This is a point you want to watch. You want to score. I'm sorry. This is kind of important. You don't want to just jack it away here. Ross Ward with the disc. Kind of a languid sort of game so far here, Dan.
Yeah, both teams really feeling each other out.
It's warm.
Yep, and not only that, but I would say, too, that both these defenses, they're doing different things on every point, and so by the time the offenses are getting a feel of what the defense is doing, it winds up being a longer point.
Yep. And it's warm and humid. Ryan Drost. Oh, boy, that's rare that you look off the Jeff Babbitt Wade shot to the end zone, but instead there's Yacht. Yacht's going to fire it to Babbitt. Ben Yacht will take it from 5 yards out. He'll lace it through the middle for Jeff Babbitt, and there's a nice connection for New York to get the break.
Babbitt's 31st of the year. There's a reason that Jeff Babbitt, I mean, his 28 Ds helps, but it's his 31 goals that's, again, showing you how important those turnovers and getting goals on those turnovers are for the Empire's winning recipe when they do win.
Well, I would argue the otherwise. I would say his Ds are more important than the 31 goals, and they don't have a winning record, so.
True.
You do need it. It's great to have him in the end zone, but they're not moving him over to the O-line.
Well, I mean, as in getting those break points.
Yeah.
As in he gets the Ds, of course. Though that's what the Empire knew they were going to get from him coming in. But the fact
Ds,
that he's
yeah.
added 31 goals while playing on that defensive line is what makes Jeff Babbitt, again, one of those extra special guys for the Empire. And he's one of those players that, yes, when they do get the wins, you usually see, including last week, 27-14 win over the Phoenix. 5 goals, 1 assist, and 4 Ds from Jeff Babbitt. That kind of tells you the story.
That's a nice line. Scores 5-3 right now. New York Empire at home here in Randall's Island in New York City against the Ottawa Outlaws. Ottawa with the disc in white. New York in black wearing their Stash uniform. Stash is a startup financial company. You should take a look at them. Through the middle, it's a catch by Ottoloni with the hammer. It hangs a little bit. Wodach has a chance. Wodach tips it. It's not caught. A nice play by John Wodach. Just tipped a little bit there, Dan. And now they're going to survey the field and take their time. The clock is at 1:42. Plenty of time here. That is Sam Taylor. Back to Wodach. Wodach will huck it. He's got Babbitt deep. Babbitt guarded. Babbitt's got the space here. Babbitt gets it. Guarded by Cooper Brotman. That's got to be scary to be guarding Jeff when he goes up over there. Jeff Babbitt now will drop it back. This is Haskell. Haskell will survey, drop it also to Lamar. And looks like there's going to be a timeout call, I want to guess. Timeout call. So listen, guys, we're going to punch into head coach CJ Ouellette and see what he has to say in the timeout.
Great team. New York. Layout ultimate gloves on the official glove of the New York Empire. Starting off.
Order online at www.outultimate.com or pick up a pair at our New York Empire merch booth.
Dan, I'm going to pipe in here and say he's not saying much in the huddle.
Well, it looks like CJ actually isn't in the huddle. Looks like the line has set up and they're talking it over, and there are some substitutions. They put their offensive out there now. So Jeff Babbitt has gone to the sideline as well as Yacht, and they brought back Garvey. They brought back Sean Keegan. So they're going now with their normal O-line teleports out there as well.
I think everyone else just sort of standing there freaked out and got out of position.
He's talking a little bit on the side. So this is interesting. Let's talk about this. They had a coaching change midway through the season.
Right.
CJ, a player formerly with the Empire, has been known as a player throughout, was the assistant coach to Tom Gibbons. Tom Gibbons taught him everything he knew about coaching, which in this case is call a timeout and get your O-line on the field. And that's great. That's good. You know, that's all you need to do sometimes.
Well, it's funny you say that because CJ was in charge of the defense. That was what his calling was. It was the defensive lines. He worried about the defensive side of the ball. So, I mean, you look at the experience of Sean Keegan, who picked up the disc here. I think he does, of course. Why would you not trust Sean Keegan to call his own offense?
And Chris Kotcher?
Of course.
I mean, World Games Chris Kotcher, Garvey. These guys are pros. Kotcher with the disc right now.
Garvey a little younger than Keegan and Kotcher.
This is true. But he plays mature.
I'll concede.
Taylor Brooks playing very well, up to Sam Little. Kotcher making a run, slid through the middle nicely to Connor Klein, and they're going to call it a goal. It's a goal. Just as you were saying, Dan, he knows how to get open. Connor Klein there finding the seam in the defense. Great timeout call from CJ. He makes it happen, just putting his O-line in, and they do the rest. Another break for New York, and they're making it look kind of easy. Not a lot of turnovers so far in this game, as the both teams have been able to work it fairly smoothly in an almost winless day here in Randall's Island.
Well, talking of Connor, statistically, he has been a lot of feast and famine throughout this year, where when he scores, he seems to score in bunches in games, and then he'll go missing for a few quarters or even a game or two, where we've seen he struggled against D.C. a few weeks ago, but then against the Phoenix in the first game in particular, he was all over. I believe he had 5 or 6 goals just in that game alone of now his 20 on the season. So, again, he's a guy that knows how to get open, and when he's feeling it, he's getting into his rhythm. He seems to be catching a lot on a certain day.
I mean, he's a great player out of UMass, followed Jeff Babbitt down here, or they came together. He might have even preceded Jeff as they played together on the same line up for Zudisk. Octoloni. This is Greg McGregor. Sorry, that's Jeremy Hill.
Jeremy Hill just coming back from a season-ending surgery in 2016.
Oh, Forrest Nault puts a nice little scooper to Nick Boucher. Nice little action there to the easy side there. Leon Forrest Nault. Boucher with the fast cut there. And he made it look easy there. Nicely done.
Yeah, Boucher, there's a reason he is the player coach. He's a smart player. He's going to have to play tons. And we see him immediately not coming out, so he's going to be on the D-line as well. And as we had talked about, Boucher normally plays on the D-line for Ottawa, but again, just due to the roster, they have to continue play the offensive side and the defensive side of the disc.
And this is something where, and when we talked to him earlier in the game, and just, he very well composed, seemed like he had things under control, said, hey, you know, we're going to see what we can do today. You know, they know they're down their numbers. But he seemed happy and confident in the team, and that's kind of what you want as your player coach out there.
And not to say, again, Ottawa, statistically, they can still make the postseason, but, again, so much would have to go right. It looks pretty bleak. So you do get to play a little bit of a spoiler as we see another turnover there.
That was Jeremy Hill right through, and there's the clockle sound, so this won't count here. But a huge D there through the middle as he read that. And not a very good play from the end of the quarter there from New York. Jeremy Hill with the play to end the quarter. So we're going to pipe out of here for a minute. Dan and Tony here. Again, the score is 6-4. The New York Empire are leading after the end of the first quarter. And we're going to listen to CJ Ouellette in the huddle. Thanks for tuning in.
Hey, if you're not getting water, bring it in here.
Hey, let's stay up. Let's stay up. Better every quarter.
Hey, if you're done getting water, bring it in, guys. Hey, that was exactly what we want to see at the end of a quarter. Unfortunately, got deep, but that was the movement that we want. We want to move it a little bit closer and have a good look. But it was unfortunate, but it was great movement. So we're coming out on defense. We're going to start with D1 coming out. That 1-3-3 is working great, so let's keep it up. I want you guys to pretend like the board's broken again, so it's just stop looking up there. We'll let you know if the time's getting low and all that stuff, but don't worry about the score. Don't worry about the score.
Are we chalkboard?
We're over here.
Hey, run on three! Run on three! 1, 2, 3!
Guys, we're going to do something fun for you here. We're going to go down and give a little field side view before the second. Sorry, we're going to do that at halftime. We're going to do that at halftime. Yeah, keep that up there. So we got amateur mistake here, Dan. That's my fault there. For some reason, I got all excited at the end of a quarter. I thought we'd have time to run down to the field. And
CJ was so engaging.
And
that's what, and you heard what he, and again, those at home got to hear what he said, and that the Empire being up by two, they like defensively what they're doing. They're going to stick with that 1-3-3. Yep. And, you know, he gave the very classic coaching mantras of don't look at the score, don't look at the time, let us handle that, and just play your game.
Well, you know, again, assessing the rest of the season, it's like, so they play Ottawa two more times after this game.
Right.
Toronto, Montreal, and Philadelphia. They have to win it all to get in the playoffs. And I said, listen, you're playing them, you're playing Ottawa now, then you're playing them again, then you're playing them again. You know, what's your strategy going to be? And they said, listen, we're thinking about one game.
Right.
That's another coaching mantra. But for this team, they need that. You know, they might have gotten ahead of themselves a little bit early in the season. Maybe the expectations about them finishing very well in the East got to them a little bit. I'm not sure. But one game at a time. Ottawa. Nice little scuba over the middle. Ochterlony. Surveying the field. Trying to find the spots. Back to Boucher. Boucher flips it up to Ochterlony. Ochterlony, great man to have in the middle here. The height and the veteran experience. Back to Boucher. We're seeing him everywhere. Boucher will fake it. He's got a man over here to his left, kind of near the camera, but drops it instead.
Yeah, that's Forrest Nolte again, but Jeff Babby, you just don't want to take a chance with that.
Except for right now, they will. And it will work as they get it to Leon Forrest Nolte. And Nolte will sling it. Is it going to be too far? It's caught. As Westwill comes up from behind and snags that out of the air. And they make it look easy on that one. Not a very effective zone from New York, I would say.
No, but as we saw in that first quarter, as I mentioned, Tony, I think, where Forrest Nolte was setting up, if he can just bring Jeff Babbitt out enough, then that's going to leave that hole. And I think for Babbitt, instead of coming with Forrest Nolte as much as he should have, because he didn't have to in that first quarter, they weren't looking towards Forrest Nolte.
Yeah.
But now on that look, now Babbitt's going to have to be a little more cognitive of coming over towards Forrest Nolte. And the question will be then, it's not going to open up space in the middle. But as we had mentioned, this might be a mute point completely if New York sees that, oh, well, maybe that's not working, and then they switch it up, either do the rabbit zone again,
yeah,
or they just go to man-to-man.
Again, without the wind, it's a big factor. Like, you really shouldn't be playing zone without wind. It's kind of silly. Like, the whole point of it is that you're forcing a less optimal throw that the wind may, you know, pop up in the air or affect your chances at it. With this kind of, you know, hot, humid, windless day, it's at a disadvantage. So we'll see how long they stay with it.
And for Ottawa now, they're one break away from tying this game up as well. So for all the turnovers they've made, the Empire, I mean, really haven't made them pay in terms of burying them on the scoreline.
Now they got to hold on offense, and we have a stall. Garvey waited too long, and now Ottawa with the chance to tie it up. And there's another whistle. Is it for complaining? No, just kidding.
For Ottawa, I would wonder if they have a little bit of trouble getting this first or second throw off, I think Ottawa might consider taking a timeout in this situation.
And put the O-line on, sure. Now he drops back 10 yards with Colin Frotz with the disc. And he's got over to this side, Colin Brotman. He gets it to Brotman. Kratz makes the cut. Harvey's got to get on his feet now. And it's up. It's slung up to Owen Watt. Watt back down to Frotz. Frotz up to Watt. Watt looking. Hits the under. Will they get someone to the end zone? There's another call here as that is Brotman with the disc. He's keep calling back. I'm not sure if these are downfield picks, Dan. I don't know if you're seeing it.
Yeah, I think the pick, they're going to call it on Mensa. Paul Mensa, number 33, who was being guarded by Taylor Brooks.
Okay.
Mensa got pretty open here on the near side.
Brotman through the middle, dangerous, but there's no defense there. Wing trying to catch up to his man. He gets him. Frank Wing D's him up.
Wang's first D of the year as well.
He really timed that well. Now the O-line back with the disc. Aletta to Garvey. Garvey wants his man deep. He's going to send it into double coverage. Mike Drost, he's got a step. Will he get there? He got there easily. A beautiful put from Harper Garvey. That's what we've seen before. And Mike Drost knew to streak to the end zone for him. And that's a nice way to come back after your first turnover on the stall. Harper Garvey to Mike Drost.
Yeah, to me that, for Ottawa, a kind of a wasted opportunity. They were 20 yards out of the end zone, and they weren't able to complete it. And that might be a rude opportunity later on where, again, maybe a timeout might have been more opportunistic in terms of taking advantage of what could have been a break.
Dan, is this one of those things where you have, where you know, you have a player coach as opposed to having a coach saying, okay, let's call this timeout right now?
Right. I think for a player, on a player side of things, you
kind of always... I mean, Boucher might have been like getting water at that
right.
point.
Well, in terms of just, I think as a player, you always think that you can do it, and you always think you have yeah. that the good feel of it. I think, yeah. and a coach is going to say, well, you know I love you all, you're great players, but no, I want to put my whole line out there, you know?
And there's Boucher right there, centering it to Westwell. Westwell with the disc. To Alexander. Alexander up.
And there's also the strategy of keeping your timeouts, particularly when a game is this close.
Right. That's a good point. Uh-oh, it's hanging. Wodach can't get there. Octoloni makes the play. Octoloni slings it back. You're not going to get a D on Octoloni too often.
Oh, he is tall and he is long.
Not even then. I'm sure Wodach is wondering what's going on here. And Octoloni makes him pay. Well, when you go up against a guy who's going to be in the Hall of Fame, that is what can happen to you as Octoloni hits Lozo in the end zone for the goal with a big-time hammer. Wodach goes up twice, and Wodach, no small man in the air. He
no.
can get up. The guy's got some ups. We saw in the MLU, the guy can jump through the roof.
Absolutely. And I think for Octoloni, another interesting thing about that matchup with Wodach on that time is that it's not that Wodach, you know, he didn't jump early. He didn't jump late. He basically jumped perfectly. It's just the way the disc was slanted and the kind of throw that was, the way it was thrown, should we say, that Octoloni went up and caught at the top of his jump as well, yeah. which is a little higher. I mean, Wodach probably has a higher vertical, but Octoloni just so long and, I mean, pretty tall as well. I believe he's 6'3", 6'4". And that would, and that's, that might even be shortchanging it a little bit.
And there's a little bit of element of, like, you've seen so many throws in your life, you just right. know where the high point of that disc
True.
Is. And so you're not going to be thrown off your game when Wodach makes what appears to be a bid, but you know where it's going to be.
And now this wouldn't apply to these players, but especially if you take time off, like let's say you have a long-term injury and you're out for a year or two, it takes a while to relearn how to read the disc.
Oh my, nice put, but it's D'd up. Sam Little saw Chris Kotcher in the end zone and had him open. So he came to the break side with a backhand, and it just wasn't enough as Khalid Alzarani gets the disc in the D. So another chance for Ottawa to tie it up with a break and get back on serve here. Let's see what they can do with their D-line. The question again, will they call a timeout and put their O-line? They only have 18 players, so...
They're also playing maybe. Tomorrow as well.
That's right. This is the first of a doubleheader for them. Nichols through the middle. McGregor. Fakes. He's looking. Nice defense. Mike Drost. One hands it. Now there's a timeout, I want to say. Looks like that whistle came from the sideline.
Yeah, it is a timeout for Ottawa.
Can't be for Ottawa if New York has the disc.
Hey, D.
It is.
Yeah, they did call for Ottawa. I thought so. I thought the official pointed towards that direction.
And now I should be upgraded by the gods of the ADL.
So the question being is, if because it was called for Ottawa, does that mean it was called, they finally got it over to this side and it was called before Mike Dross got that D?
I can't imagine. The refs are talking about it right now. Let's see if our cameraman takes a look at them and we can read some lips.
Well, not playing today for the Empire, but you see the one white shirt in the Empire huddle in Isaiah Bryant, and you talk about a vet around the game. He's, when you talk about the Octolones of the world, while Bryant isn't necessarily at that level, Isaiah Bryant has been around the New York and Philadelphia Ultimate community for close to a decade now as well, playing at a high level on numerous teams in both the New York and Philadelphia metropolitan areas.
Well, let's see what Izzy told him. I think New York is going to be coming in with the disc. They have their... I'm actually somewhat confused. No,
it is their D-line that stayed out there. So I believe that that timeout must have been called prior to the turnover, right. And so it just, again, retroactively took a little while to get to this sideline.
Well, great timeout call there from Ottawa. They must have been listening to us when we were questioning whether they were... how efficient they would be on their timeout.
Well, they are playing and coaching, so listening to us would big three, that'd be a difficult task.
So a double team here, Matt Lamar and Ben Yacht will come in on Westwell with the disc. Great timeout call from Ottawa. And as the big 6'6 Yacht gets broken to the backside, Boucher with the disc. He will center it to Alexander. Alexander looking around. And now they're trying to find space. It's a man defense here. And it's a big huck. He's got space. It's away. Will it stay up for him? And he does. He toes the line. That's a goal. And they'll call it in. Great play from Jeremy Hill on the away cut. He beat Babbitt to the deep end. And he got shot down there. Octorlone found him. Great play from Ottawa to even it up. The pressure is on New York now as they've given up a break. And this game is tied.
Yeah, Hill did a really good job that time of that balance between finding the disc and finding your feet. And again, it takes a lot of time and experience to learn when to look up and when to keep your eyes on the disc and then when to look down and see if you're going to be in bounds or out of bounds. And Hill, again, reading the projection of the disc, was able to just stay in bounds and kind of ran onto the disc. It timed his run perfectly. I mean, sometimes, Tony, it's not just a 100% sprint all the way, because sometimes, again, with the way the disc floats in, sometimes it's better to catch it in stride, in motion, in that way.
And tiptoe the line. So the Ottawa Outlaws, depleted as they are staying tough in this game. And now, again, a question of New York's character. And this pull will come down to Taylor Brooks, up to Harper Garvey. Quick pull play set up for Sam Little, who's trying to get open. And, oh, that's Kotcher, sorry. Kotcher now with the disc.
Yeah, Chris Kotcher's a guy that you'd like to put in an isolation play like that.
So at what point, Dan, do they bring over Ben Yacht and Jeff Babbitt to the O-line? Big hug.
Oh, sorry, Sam.
Wow. Brooks had the juke from Sam Little and threw it anyway, and it was a little mistimed. Brotman with the disc.
Mensa, easy D there.
And now they're moving quick and easily. New York has got to get on their heels right now. Got to get on their feet. I'm sorry, they're on their heels. And it's centered up to number 14, Kyle Cantel. Cantel looking. He's bottled up. He's going to have to put it. Oh, nice sneaky pass for the goal and another break to Pierre Lemaire. The count was getting up high. Cantel didn't have much to do. He had his man going away. It was defended well, and he just put it to a spot where no one else could get it but his man. And that's another break for Ottawa as they take the lead and the serve.
Klein doesn't very often have to be on defense set up on an island like that in that situation. And it was really good patience there by the number 14 in Kyle Cantel just to wait. And then, again, with a stall high, he just had to take a chance. And so what younger players should never do is have to flip shoulders back and forth.
Yeah.
And we saw that Lamel, his eyes went over his left shoulder, right shoulder, and then there was the disc right on him. And to answer your earlier question about at what point do you put Yacht or Babbitt on the move then to the O-line, I don't think there's an exact science to it, but I think if you look back at a lot of those Empire games, when they're down by three or four in the second half and the game is, we'll say, still in reach, I think that's the moment when it's kind of happened.
That's too late, though, right?
Well, it's again, they're a team that is 3-6.
So yeah, exactly.
Not has necessarily
hasn't proven successful.
But that. Also, Babbitt is a guy that all these guys can run for days, but you don't want to burn. They are young. I know they're in their early 20s, but you don't want to burn those guys out.
Holy Moses, what a hug from Sean Keegan to Frank Wing. Well, you don't need Babbitt in the end zone if Sean Keegan's going to lay one on a platter for you. As he winds up from 60 and hits Frank Wang in stride, no chance for the defense. An easy hold for New York at 8. So let's hope this gives him some momentum. At least let's hope for that team. And if you're here following Ottawa, they are staying strong and tough and have tied this game up with the break advantage here about to receive on offense.
And as we mentioned, Tony, I think that's the other reason why you don't put Babbitt and Yacht on early on is that you trust Keegan, you trust Garvey, you trust their throws to be able to run their offense and get it done before you necessarily have to go to a Yacht and a Babbitt. And as per chemistry, as what we talked about with head coach CJ Gillette before the game, is that, you know, Yacht and Babbitt, they're used to the D-line. You play with the same guys on that D-line and trying to switch things up, you're playing with new players. And, yeah, they practice together all the time, but in this, when you're playing in a game time action, and you do want to know exactly where your teammates are before you throw it to them.
Well, Ottawa so far has proven to be very resilient on offense, as the New York defense has not been able to do much. Boucher playing often and is doing well out there. Nick Boucher with the disc.
Boucher against Holmes is a really good matchup. I like that out there with the work rate of Holmes, but those crafty moves and cuts of Boucher, we just saw another one there.
Yep. Set up his cut very nicely. Now he'll drop it back down for Alexander.
Boucher also a lefty. Pretty important note
to be on that side, especially as a left. Double team on Jeremy Hill as he goes right through the middle, right through Ross Ward and Ben Yacht. Now Alexander looking. Nice offense from Ottawa. They're feeling very confident. Hill with the disc. Count's getting up high. He doesn't want to be bailed out with the foul. He slings it through the middle. It's going to hang, but it's going to be a goal if it stays. Is he caught it in or caught it out? They're ruling him out of bounds. Very close one. He had him. It hung a little bit, popped in the air. Wang was there on the D. Sorry, Aloro.
And Yacht's been beat a few times through the double teams, but you saw that one-on-one defense from Yacht there. And absolutely smothering. It was a high stall count, but Empire gives it right back.
Bad footwork from Aloro. He never planted his feet, didn't bend his knee, and a lazy throw to Wodatch results in a short field for Ottawa. See if they take advantage. 4 minutes left on the clock. Sorry, 4:50. A quick up by Boucher. Boucher serving. This should be an easy one. He drops it upfield. Babbitt tries to make a play, but he can't. It's spiked down disc as the Ottawa score is complete. Babbitt down to the turf. That was an exciting point there for Ottawa.
For Luzo, that is his fourth goal of the day. And he came in with 14 so far in the season, just one behind Forrest Nault. Those two were the leading scorers, not counting all the players who were missing. Again, the way Ottawa was set up coming into this game, Arsenal with 40 goals. The next closest was Forrest Nault with 15.
Okay.
That just tells you how important he was to their offense. Then you had Luzo with 14 coming in. Now he's got four. And Ochterlony as well, two assists for him today, but he came in with 14 goals.
And you start to question New York's character. This is a great character building test for this New York team. Hey, they're supposed to be the talented team. They've got the better, more guys here. It's a home field thing. Seven players from Ottawa are in France competing for the World Championships of Beach Ultimate right now. This should be a cakewalk for a team that crushed Philadelphia last weekend.
Right.
Philadelphia beat Ottawa. All the pieces are there for New York, and they're down one. So let's see what they can do. Garvey will lace this through the center, put a little bit of mustard on it. Can Dross get there? Oh, it's too low and too fast.
That one got picked up by the wind about 5 yards after it was released from Garvey's hand. You saw the wind push it down just enough. And so it was too low for Mike Drost.
You know, it's been a little bit of a languid game, and this is where I want to see New York's defense really stiffen up here. Keegan, it pops up. This could be anybody's disc. Sam Little looking. Sam Little, everybody's looking for it. Sam Little gets it. I don't want to give that credit to New York's defense, though. Keegan. Keegan, well, oh, my. Too far for Connor Klein. And they rushed it. It's the only way to say it. And he rushed that throw.
Yeah, just on this point alone, both offenses have been a little bit out of whack.
Frustrated, Sean Keegan boots the cone out of the way. And Ottawa will pick it up.
It smiles on both sides, so they're having a good laugh of it.
I love kicking cones when I'm upset. It's like the best thing. Nichols. And there's a call.
There was a call there. Mike Dross colliding with Carson Turner. And Turner saying that Dross is holding him. And Dross really, really close to the Callahan there. I think that's what the argument was, with that, you know, both players getting a little bit too physical. So the officials stepping in, having a word with them both.
So this is the fine line where New York is getting a little upset now and they're trying to tighten up on D. And
right.
Can you do that without getting silly fouls and without losing your composure?
And getting beat deep, particularly.
Yep. And we're about to find out. Lamarle. And now Ottawa's running faster, too. So both teams have a little juice in them now. The big huck. And Sam Little against Merzan. He bumps him. There's some bumping around. And it tips. And it's no call. Keegan is there. Little is there. And Mr. Mensah is there, and it's a turnover.
Yeah, I think Keegan will probably get credit with the D for that. I think it was Keegan who knocked it away. And that's what Sam Little does, again, the unceremonious part of it, is to pull the offensive player away.
Connor Klein again with an opportunity here, and he gets this one. The Keegan to Connor Klein connection works there. Oh, the lefty, they're trying too much. I'm not sure Sam was looking for the lefty upfield there. I would have liked to see him come back for the dump cut there. And these turnovers are starting to add up. Will it wear down New York?
Yeah, you have to remember, as you just mentioned, Tony, this is the offensive line out there.
Eric Hunter with the disc. Gets it past Drost upfield. This is the D-line for Ottawa. They are not bringing on their O-line, so it's the D-line with the disc versus the O-line on defense. Hunter through the center to Lamarle. Lamarle.
What a break this would be for Ottawa to go up two for the first time in this game.
I agree.
As we near halftime, just 1:41 left on the clock.
Yeah, this is a big point. Hunter exhorting his team to go. They look a little tired. This is Nichols through the middle. Where are the openings? Slings it upfield. That's to Cantel. Cantel gets it to Lamero. Lamero to Hunter. Now it's a chance in the end zone for Cantel. It's a goal. Ottawa has done it. Their defense finally gets the break. And the demoralized New York offense will walk off the field. And the New York defensive line will come on to take their place for this next offensive point.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, you look at how long that point was, just in terms of sheer energy and length. I mean, it's not even about, you know, emotion or character or this or that. It's simply that you've played I believe it was about a 5.5 minute point of game time. Now we've only got 1:16 left. So for New York, you have to try to answer here. And you put your D-line out. And I think for the D-line, that is kind of that team character. Not necessarily just the guys on the offensive line, but that defensive line has to see the offense struggle and say, well, now we need to get three straight points to try to take a lead into halftime, or at least with only 1:16 left, get 1 or 2 points back to try to tie this one up going into the break.
Can't wait to pipe in to see what the halftime conversation is about. Wodach, who was on the O-line for the first part of the season with this man here, Josh Aloro. And Ryan Holmes making a nice cut. Holmes, I think, played great. Here's Yacht. He's open. Oh, Wodach missed him. Nice setup cut from Watt. Oh, that was close to a stall count. Lamar with the disc. Yacht's got to get out. Back to Lamar. 52 seconds left on the clock. Lamar looking. Lamar looking for Wodach, but slings it across Aloro instead. Now Yacht is here with yardage, guarded by Boucher. Yacht will put it to Babbitt, but it's low, easily D'd up. Now Ottawa with the third chance for a three-point goal. Sorry, first chance for a three-point goal. Boucher will pick it up. This is their O-line, so it's the it's the reverse. To Westwell. Sorry, McGregor. Boucher will put it deep. He's got an open man. Lamar is there on defense, but it's not enough. A beautiful put from Boucher, and that is another goal. Jeff Bavon scores it, and Ottawa surprisingly is streaking ahead in the second quarter. They were down by 2 in the beginning of this quarter,
yep.
Dan, and now they're doing nothing but leading.
And even just in this quarter alone, Kyle Cantal came in. He'd only played 10 points all season long, and he has a goal and an assist in this quarter.
In this quarter.
Yeah, and meanwhile, you look at the goal just scored by Jeff Pavone. Pavon. He had one assist coming into this game, and now he scores his first goal of the season. So for Ottawa, the point to win this game was that they had to find ways to replace the production of all the players they have at World Beaches, and they have so far in this first half absolutely done that and more. Again, getting a number of guys contributing their first points of the season.
It's been all about Ottawa so far in the second quarter, as 13 seconds remain here in the second. Keegan with the disc. Centers it to Kotcher. Kotcher. Garvey. Garvey looking. Back to Keegan. Keegan will send this one deep. Will he send it to Yacht or Babbitt? Or through the middle to no one. It's a turn. It's a bit of an off game here for Keegan, and he knows it. And that's going to be the end of your second quarter. It's 11-8. Ottawa has New York on the ropes. New York loses this game. The postseason is going to look pretty far out of reach.
At this time, we would like to thank Sys NY for their involvement with our organization.
So what we're going to do is we're going to take a little break here, and then Dan and I will go down to the field, and we'll check out the AstroTurf or talk about a few things down there. So stay with us, and we'll be right back with you.
We also run a successful youth summer league at McCarran Park in Brooklyn and send youth teams to a national championship this summer. We host adult leagues in Manhattan, Brooklyn, Queens, and the Bronx, and started a
nothing
women's
about
development
that,
league
but,
now entering
if
its
you tell me you're not good,
season. In the past year, the organization
I had already looked away and called Pippen it.
And east so. Of the city as clubs from Long Island and Westchester are now affiliated with Disc NY.
I'd rather not have the confusion.
At www.discny.org.
I disagree with that. If you say you're not good, just keep it at that. It doesn't matter. Once you've told me you're not good, I'm already calling someone in, and I've told them they're in. I understand, but...
All right, make us look good, Josh.
I'm not a miracle worker.
I mean, if you want, we could talk about the division between the
buckets.
Between the.
You hear that?
The trees and the.
Let's talk about the outer, the wind, the frisbee, and just the feeling.
We need a disc here, Dan. Let's see if we can find one. Hey, do you mind if we can we play with you guys?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, what's your name?
Emery Ford.
Emery Ford? Okay, cool. And do you play Ultimate?
I do, yeah.
Where do you play?
I used to play at the University of South Carolina.
South Carolina? What are you doing up here in New York?
I moved here for a job.
Okay, cool. And what's your favorite throw?
A thumber is always a good option.
Thumber. Okay, we're going to watch the thumber.
Oh, no.
Here we go. No pressure. No pressure, Emily. Now, for you watching at home, here's the thumber. That's a pretty nice thumber. We call that a scoober. Maybe in South Carolina they call it a thumber.
Dan, do you think that's a thumber?
Oh, that's a nice one, too.
What's her name, Emily?
Lauren Reed.
Lauren Reed. Okay, Lauren, can we come and interview you next? She seems pretty psyched about it.
She's a Roughnecks fan.
Roughnecks fan. All right, Dan, you got this one. You know the Roughnecks?
The Dallas Roughnecks?
Yeah.
Pretty good.
All right. Who do you want to talk? Who? You're next. Lauren, tell us
Dallas Roughnecks plan. That's a team that, just looking at that division this year, and we're going to face the camera here.
Oh, there's a camera.
Again, for the AUDL audience at home. And so looking at the Roughnecks in that division in particular, it's been pretty good. You looked at the roster turnover this year, but they still, again, have plenty of talent down there in the South.
Yeah, totally. Jimmy Mickle's probably my favorite. But, yeah, I'm from Dallas, so that's my home team. But, yeah, I'm staying in New York for the summer, so this is my team away from home. Yeah.
And you're seeing, again, some of those players that have in the past come, like Chris Mazur, came from New York, was playing both in the MLU and then headed down to Dallas to play with the Roughnecks. And he's, again, one of their big players, along with, as you had mentioned, a former Pittsburgh prospect in terms of Jimmy Mickle as well as Dylan Freechild as well. But, again, as far as the atmosphere, too, the AUDL playing on this AstroTurf is, when you're trying to look at and think about, as you're throwing here, what the players are having to do, you're noticing that when you're sitting in the bleachers that there's a little more wind than you'd expect here on the field.
Yeah, definitely. I did notice that. Definitely different.
Yeah, swirling wind around the middle, and that led to a few turnovers. And as we're actually going to get a chance to talk to an Empire player in Sean Keegan. Hey, Sean, how's it going?
Good, how are you?
Pretty good. So, Sean, looking at that first half, in the first quarter, it seemed to be things were really clicking. You were up to 6-4. In the end of the first quarter, then what happened there in the second quarter?
I think we took a few kind of selfish shots, myself included. We just got a little bit stuck looking at the end zone, trying to force it a bit. And kudos to Ottawa. They were playing some good D, like expecting us to look for the end zone. And, you know, just when you try to jam in the end zone, it's not going to be successful. We had two, I think, right in this corner. You know, a few deep looks that were kind of 50-50s, and those aren't the looks we want to be taking. So we just got to be smarter about the shots we're looking to take and, you know, exploit the defense they're setting up. Right now we're playing into their defense.
I have a question for you, Sean. How does the team keep its confidence and you yourself keep your confidence? You look definitely very frustrated here. You kick the cone over, stuff I love to do personally.
Pylon.
How do you, the pylon, yes. Yeah. How do you keep your composure in a game that you know, are down?
I mean, me personally, I'm always very confident in my abilities. I know, you know, despite throwing a turnover, I know I'm a good thrower, and you know, I'm not worried about the next deep throw. I'll come out and throw it if the guy's there. Team-wise, I mean, it's tough, right? Like, you go from up 6-4. You know, I think we're down 3 now. And it's like, well, shoot. Like, we feel like we should be winning. I think, you know, we believe we're the better team. So I think, you know, getting our confidence back up, it's going to come down to, you know, scoring a consistent 0 point when we come out of half. And, you know, get our D-line back in the field. They're the ones that got us the lead. So, you know, we'll let the big guys, Babbitt, Yacht, Wodatch on D, go out there and, you know, get us back in the game. That's where we're going to win and make our money.
What did Coach CJ tell you in the huddle?
Right. I think the halftime huddle is to come, more or less. I think we're kind of letting ourselves decompress a little bit after the end of the half. You know, I'm sure it'll be play confident, like you're saying, right? Like, we're body language isn't great. Like, we're all a bit frustrated with how things shook out. Yeah. So I think it's just going to be get back to our game, you know, take the right shots. I think look to break the mark and get ourselves some easier possessions on O, and I think that'll do a lot for our confidence.
Okay. Dan, any more questions?
No, sounds good. Here?
Cool.
Good luck, sir.
Thank you very
Looking
much.
Forward to our second half.
Yeah, thank you guys. Well,
thank you.
Well, that was Dan. Dan Hilton and Tony Leonardo with you with Sean Keegan and some folks out here in the field. And thanks for tuning in. We'll come back up and get ready for the second half.
Everybody,
hey everybody, we're going to be coming back in for the third quarter here, the second half of the New York Empire home game here in New York City versus the Ottawa Outlaws. New York Empire coming in at 3-5, the Ottawa Outlaws at 2-6, is that right?
It's 2-6 and 3-5.
Yeah. Tony Leonardo here and Dan Hilton on the call for you. And we have an interesting game. We have a first quarter that was in control for New York. Didn't look too dissimilar from their last week's game against Philadelphia. But they had a couple breaks up. They were up 6-4 at the end of the quarter. Ottawa comes down, starts the second quarter, scores a goal on offense. 6-5, Octorlone being playing well there. And from there, I don't know what happened. Basically, a little bit of an unravelment. Couple of easy short goal opportunities down here. Of course, Keegan, we saw at halftime just talking about that. Missed opportunities. They work at full field as Ottawa and scores. The D-line comes on for New York. They can't get it done. Another score is Boucher, the player coach for Ottawa, throws the goal. And it's a three-goal deficit now for the New York Empire. Their season on the line.
Yes, 7-2 run there, of course, in the second quarter after being down 6-4 at the end of the first, being Ottawa. And, you know, you looked at Sean Keegan, and he even had said that they're going to do their halftime talk after the players decompress a little bit, because I think with only 24 minutes left here between the third and fourth quarters, while they are taking it game by game, again, they know that a loss here means that they are basically eliminated from the postseason. So they know they're going to have to win here. And I think for the Empire, you look at, while they are 3-5, and yes, they have played Philadelphia, and that accounts to it, but they have an 18-point differential, as in they've won games by large margins or they've lost close, is what 18 tells me. And yeah. Montreal, meanwhile, 7-4 with a one-point differential, as in just a positive one. So they have won close, or they have lost by a lot.
Well, the point differentials can be a little bit misleading. So one of the Montreal games, they lost by 15 points or whatever it was to New York when they were coming off of a back-to-back. They had played in Philadelphia and an overtime loss the night before, had a bus ride here to New York, played an early Sunday game, and that was a big point differential loss for them. And in a meaningless game, they already got their win on the road.
But don't a lot of it, pretty much every team plays under those circumstances over the course of the season. So you would think that it does wind up evening itself out.
Well, Keegan on the board now to Connor Klein. The Eric Hunter came under there. Sorry, Jeff Bavon came under for Ottawa to try to get the goal. The D on Keegan. And Keegan found the spot there and hit Connor Klein away. So Garvey to Kotcher. Kotcher with the hockey assist to Keegan. Keegan to Klein. And the offense holds for the first one. It's now 9-11.
For Keegan, that's just his second assist. We had one assist in all of the first quarter. And now picking up his second here to Connor Klein with his fourth goal. And as promised, again, Connor Klein continues to get the goals today. But Keegan, I think it's, while he may have mentioned, he said he trusts his throws. He knows he's a confident player, so keep playing the way he's playing. But to get him get an early assist, get him seeing the disc into a teammate's hands, into the end zone, I think is a good sign for the confidence of New York.
Well, and now back to what Keegan had said, which is let's get our D on the field and see what they can do. Yacht, Babbitt, Drost, Aloro, Matt Lamar marking. And it's a quick setup play. Turn away, man, and it's a bit, and it's short. And, that's Octolone with the disc. Octolone looking. And a nice play call right off the bat there. New York did nothing to stop that play call. Octolone finds some space. Defended by Holmes. And, Taylor's guarding him.
It's a tough matchup for Sam Taylor, of course.
Sorry, that was not Taylor. That is Holmes guarding him. And Jeremy Hill with the disc, looking. Okay, the defense is holding right now for New York. Can they get a stall out of this? And they got one. It was getting up close. The juke, excellent defense from Josh Aloro, shut down Westwell's cut, and that produced the stall count. A quick stall, 7 here as Wodatch will pick it up. Yacht is going deep. This disc hung. It's short. Can Yacht get up the ladder? He cannot. Oh, it's tipped and caught by Ryan Drost. Ryan Drost will drop it back for Lamar. Lamar to Ben Yacht for the goal. A lucky break for New York, and they make it count. The crowd pretty excited about that one as New York is climbing back into it.
And Ryan Drost kind of shows you what one of the benefits of being teammates of a Yacht or a Babbitt is that while they may not catch every disc, they bring so much pressure from the rest of the Ottawa players. I mean, Yacht had two players surrounding him, so that leaves Ryan Drost open over the top. And so, you know, I'm not a tall guy, nor was I a very good ultimate player, but I know that I let my taller teammates, much like yourself, standing well over 6 feet, you guys go up, get in the scrum, get in the disc, and if I can just sneak in behind,
yeah,
possibly get, you know, that second effort, second attempt, and Ryan Drost did a really good job to lay out and find his way onto that disc.
Very good point there, as you're right. Yacht drew two, and Drost was there to pick it up. And it looks like Yacht's staying on the line right now, so they've already, and Babbitt staying on the line. Sorry, well, this is the D-line.
But I also think, excited, for momentum's sake, Tony, you got two quick scores. Now you're only down by one, and this is where you want to get another break and bring yourself back into this game.
Well, the first thing they'll tell you is get those pulls in bounds, as an out-of-bounds pull will slow down a little bit of that momentum. Westwell for Ottawa. Let's see about Ottawa's composure now. It's a little bit of a junky zone look. Holmes is the rabbit guarding Westwell. He centers, slings it to Boucher. Boucher looking, taking his time. He's got Hill to the left. He finds Jeremy Hill. Jeremy Hill looks it. It's still in this kind of funky-looking zone here as Ottawa is trying to survey and find out where the openings are. And they get it to Hunt. Oh, almost a D from Alara, but it's no good. Octolone. Sorry, that was Nichols. He'll drop it back to Nichols. Nichols looking.
It's the number 22, Ian Guerin, who was actually activated for this game.
I was wondering about that. I didn't see him on the original roster. Yeah.
Yep, he was activated for this game after, I believe, it was Matt Cat Stevens was unable to play.
This one will hang up in the air. This should be all Babbitt. Babbitt's loping over there. Takes his time and skies. Jeff Babbitt with the D. As that disc hung up in the air. Now it's the defensive line opportunity again for a break score for New York. This is going to be a big huck attempt. It hangs again. Another hanger. Ross Ward's going to have to read this one with the Ottawa defender. Track down. And there's a collision as people go down. That is why they call those a hospital pass. As Haskell's throw was a little lazy.
Yeah, the wind just picked it up. Took it a lot, and for Ward, you can see that Ward had kind of already set up in a former football player in Ross Ward. He kind of set up preparing to back himself down and back up his opponent, you know, almost like you would playing basketball on the block.
Yeah.
But that disc continued to hang up in the air the way it did.
You got to give credit to Nichols there for tracking that down. He came from way downfield to come back for that disc and make that play. Guarded by Guerin. Guerin also, by the way, made an excellent D earlier in the quarter that I called this home, so my mistake on that. He slings it to Octorlone. Octorlone, the veteran presence for both teams. He is probably the most elite player on the field today for either side. Nichols. Nichols will sling it up deep. It'll hang. Two defenders there, and it's D'd up by Alaro. Okay, another chance, opportunity here. Do you call a timeout if you're CJ? Ooh, boy. Bad footwork is always the cause for that, as Ross Ward's throw finds the turf. How many more D's can New York get, and how many more chances will Ottawa have to score this offensive point? Octolone centers to Westwell. Go ahead, Dan.
I would say that handlers blame handlers for bad footwork, but then cutters blame other cutters for not being open.
Oh, what a sky! Unbelievable sky over Ross Ward. As it goes up, Boucher collects another assist as he slings it to the far side. I didn't see who got that.
It was Scott Westwell with his second goal of the game.
Amazing play. Westwell, you see, rise up over the ground, high point the disc, and all for naught. Two Ds on lazy throws, and that's the thing you really want to stomp down. It's one thing to get an amazing play, but when the other team throws two bad throws,
right,
you want to take advantage and just say, like, we have the confidence and we have the mental edge, and you know, you're throwing crappy throws, we're going to punish you for that.
Right.
And they did not punish them. New York Empire failed to capitalize.
You know, and sometimes, I mean, one of the underrated parts, I think, of Jeff Babbitt's game is that even though it doesn't look like he ever takes a step out, again, he is about 6'4", so he doesn't necessarily need to take a large step out to pivot to get around the defender. But he's got a 98% passing percentage this year. Every throw he makes seemingly is the right throw because, again, he usually just is resetting, getting back to a handler, resetting the offense, and taking his time and getting things set.
And here's where you start talking jitters for New York. They know their season's on the line. Do people start to get nervous? Kotcher, one man who will not get nervous. Mike Drost now with the disc. also a pretty steady presence, but you got to wonder if everyone has the same composure on this team. Frank Wang with the disc. Count's getting high. He's got a release. Finds Garvey. Garvey sees, I think this is Little. I can't tell from here. No, that's Kotcher. Kotcher up to Little. Little. Two very similar players, Chris Kotcher and Sam Little.
Kotcher gets open so quickly on those dump cuts.
Yeah, he switches his positioning very quickly. Sam Taylor up to Little. Little will holster. Drop it to Garvey. Garvey out to Kotcher. Kotcher wants Wang. Nope. Now he wants Aletta. Nope. Now he'll send it deep. He's got a wide open Mike Dross. Can Mike Dross sling this out, tiptoe it in? No. Mike Dross will then dump it upfield to Sam Little for the goal. Or Haskell. I think it's Haskell with the ponytail. I've been calling him wrong all game. Can I tell? Can I see? Is it 13 or 18?
No, that's 13. That is Sam Little.
That is Sam. Okay, good. Yeah. Sam's growing his hair out.
And it's getting hot. It's perfect weather for that, Tony.
Growing your hair out?
Oh, yeah.
Do you prefer ponytail or pigtails, Dan?
Me? I've had the same haircut since I was about 3 years old, as you saw that on the field. It hasn't really changed. It's been the same thing.
But yeah, is there a reason for that?
You never change, Tony.
You never change.
Never change.
Sad. I've tried so many times to change. Well, a good hold there from New York. They needed that, Dan.
Yeah, it's really important that throughout that point, there were a number of times that you would use the word holster particularly Sam Little on this near side, there were a number of times that he could have thrown it deep, looked for a shot to Mike Dross, and said he was very patient, continued to work through the middle, Harper Garvey playing that center point, and again, the work rate of Chris Kotcher, he will get open. So just, again, continue to work your offense through those guys like Kotcher, and eventually you'll find yourself in the end zone.
That's a 1-3 zone here. Sorry, 1-3-3. So they got a rabbit on the mark, and then they got a sort of a wall of three guys.
And even without much wind, this did work to pretty good effect in that first quarter when they took that 6-4 lead.
Haskell is the rabbit. Wing gets up, and it's almost a Callahan. What a play from Frank Wang. Frank Wang goes up fast, gets up high, skies, and drops it to Ryan Dross for the goal. Beautiful play.
Now, while Yacht, of course, you know, showed up in the whole AUDL kind of knew Yacht was coming to New York, Frank Wang is a guy that has worked his way up from being a reserve player, not expecting to see him on the roster, and now you see that he is a part of that offense. When they say we need our O-line out there, Wang has asserted himself onto the O-line, and you can see getting the D there and then immediately finding a teammate for the score, and more importantly, tying the game up at 12.
Well, excellent job from Frank Wang. I think the only thing is he would have wished it might have been a Callahan, but love that the tenacity here. Now we're seeing this team focused and kind of dialed
right
in. But they've just got it back to even. Will they be able to keep it up for the rest of the game? We'll find out. The D-line stays on. Wodach with the pull.
I believe that's Holmes. So that is Ryan Holmes with the pull.
Holmes with the pull. This is not the rabbit defense, but this is the rabbit defense. This is up to Jeremy Hill. It's a 1-3-3 zone. Now it looks like it's crumbling to man. Into the middle, Lamar guarding Boucher. Boucher's put on a show, and he's going to send another one. Nice put. This is going to be an easy goal. Boucher, you've got to put a man. This is becoming the Nick Boucher show. Someone's got to find out what to do about him. I don't know if their scouting reports have been sufficient enough. Nick Boucher has the green light to put it in the end zone, and he's doing it with impunity right now as he finds Jeremy Hill on the away cut.
Yeah, do you find, Tony, that lefties just always seem to be able to find that space on those pivots? And Boucher, just very simple, the way he just, again, that disc kind of glides right out of his hand. You can see certain guys, when they take their steps out, they make their pivots, they seem to be taxing a little more, and Boucher just, you know, in rhythm, a very smooth player, if you will.
So get him out of rhythm. What is New York doing?
Right.
Like, is there not someone who's noticed that he's thrown 3 or 4 or 5 goals? I mean, actually, you might have kept track. How many goals has he thrown so far?
Boucher has 3 assists on the day, 1 goal as well.
He's making it look easy. So someone's got to get up on him and either force him middle,
right,
play him straight up, put a little body to start. I don't know what.
And
but
they put a number of different defenders on him as well. And that's what head coach CJ Ouellette had said, that they would switch up the defense, not give the same looks. And so no matter what defender New York has put on him, Boucher has been able to find those gaps.
Up to the O-line again. Back and forth we go. Sean Keegan with the disc. He will send it deep. He's got a lace throw to Connor Klein. Will he find the spot for it? He does! Keegan with the green lights. I don't know how he does it. Keegan gets down low with that throw release point, zips it into the end zone. Connor Klein tracks it down for the goal.
Second time those two have hooked up this quarter. Keegan now with 3 assists and Klein with 5 goals. And again, going back to the interview with him at halftime, yes, it seemed like even though he was saying everything is fine, we're calm, we're collected, you could tell that they had been frustrated in that first half. But as Keegan had mentioned to us, that he trusts his throws, he knows he's a very good thrower. And while they were making those big throws and they considered them bad decisions, that time Klein was alone on an island, and Klein even had the 2 or 3 steps on his defender. And while the disc did move with the wind a little bit, Klein had to reread it. Klein is the kind of guy that is quick enough to make up that space when the disc doesn't necessarily go the way he expected it to be.
Well, we have a great match here, folks. 13-all, 5.5 left in the third quarter. Octoloni guarded by Wodach. Octoloni slings it through the middle. As an open man is Boucher. Drops it back down for Alexander. Alexander to Octoloni. Octoloni looking. He drops it over. Now both teams are in rhythm here. And in up, Boucher. Boucher with a big hammer. Will it hang? And it's deed up by Drost. And it is deed. It tipped up Ryan Drost. Eyes on the disc the whole time. He gets the D. They've recognized the Boucher. Well, has the green light to put it. And they got this one. Wodach now. Can this line convert? Lamar fakes it. Yacht trying to find space. Yacht will, go deep. It hang a little bit. Can Yacht get there? It's deed up. It's too easy to throw. Not enough there. And he's not giving up a lot of space there is Leon Forrest-Nault, also a guy with some height. And
yeah,
he goes.
Forrest-Nault probably, other than Octoloni, is basically the one and two guys on Ottawa that have that height to match up with some of the larger guys, or taller guys, should we say, on the Empire.
So you see Yacht going deep, and Lamar had end zone eyes and put it for him, and it was a turn. And now Ottawa back with the disc on O. Lazo for Boucher. They're giving him, now they are kind of forcing him back the other way when he dishes it over the center. Westwell goes through the middle.
They're looking for Lazo downfield, and he's already got 4 goals, so you see the reason why.
Right. Alexander pops this up. It's collected, however, by Jeremy Hill. Back up to Forrest-Nault. Forrest-Nault, Dr. Alexander. Now they're out of rhythm as New York. This should be an easy goal. And it is. Ottawa collects the garbage, scores the goal. Going up to Lazo, just as you called it, Dan.
And certain guys like Lazo and Klein on the other side, you know, we're at the point in the season, Tony, where for Ottawa they played 8 games. As well as the Empire, they've also played 8 games. And so you're at the point in the season where these guys have played together, not only this season, but multiple players on the Empire and Ottawa have played together for multiple seasons, not just in the AUDL, but, you know, you're talking club. A lot of these guys have played together in college. So we're in the point in the season when chemistry shouldn't be an issue at all. You know the guys that are going to be in the end zone, and it's about being a team. It's about being unselfish. So you're going to notice the same guys are catching in the end zone because that's where their cuts are going to be made, and that's where their teammates know where to find them. So Lazo is that guy for Ottawa in the same way that Klein's been that guy for the New York so far.
Keegan with the disc. Fakes it to Little. Little up to Haskell. Haskell, big fake. Haskell surveys, trying to find Keegan on the reset. He's got to get rid of it quick. He does to Connor Klein. Klein looking for Little downfield. Now finds Little. I love that setup right there. Can't get the away. Then you get 10 yards upfield. Little's got to look upfield. He's got wing upfield. There we go. Wing slides to the turf. Had a lead on that side, but dropped it back. That's okay. Drost. Ooh, wow. He picked it up. Took his eyes off it. Had an open man in the end zone. Was able to collect it. Keegan will find the goal now. It's a Connor Klein again, as you called it, Dan Hilton. This is a tit-for-tat game. Back and forth we go, tied at 14s right now.
Yeah, it really is offensively turning into Keegan to Klein or Boucher to Lazo. And that has been the combination now in this third quarter as they continue to go back and forth. So, Tony, you're getting to a point with the third quarter, 3:24 left. you know, between the third and the fourth quarter, it might be that one team that can get one or two breaks and make a little bit of a run. Because at this point, the way this game has been, if you're up by two, you could put yourself in a good place, should I say, to win the game.
Yeah, that's kind of what it comes down to, is the break, you know, yep. Getting that break advantage. Traditionally, I think in the ADL, it's less important. Any team can score at any moment, really.
True.
So,
and I think it also depends on the game as well. We talked about a game between New York and Montreal. Actually, pretty much every New York-Montreal game where we've seen huge runs in those games where the Empire blew out Montreal, yet Montreal's beaten the Empire by 6 or 7. So, yeah. You know, we've seen, and particularly on the West Coast, where things are really, the disc is flying through the air at a rapid pace, plenty of offense there. So, you know, you could go on a 4-goal run in a hurry, but make up that time. And this is the kind of game where that's just not going to happen.
Nice scuba dump for Forrest Nault. And Boucher puts it up. It's going to hang a little bit. Can Alora get there? And he cannot. It's collected instead by Westwell. As Ottawa hangs on, Boucher racking up the points again.
So any doubts we had before this game, you know, this is the first time that the Empire have seen Boucher so far this year. Again, this is the first matchup between the two and, you know, final home game for the Empire. But for Boucher, we hadn't gotten a chance to see him too much up in Ottawa, but he can clearly play and coach at the same time. As you had mentioned earlier to your point, that, I mean, he is the one who's running, the offense is running through Boucher. Absolutely running through Boucher. He's the guy making those big throws, and he's the guy getting himself open.
And I just wonder if, you know, they don't put a big body on him.
Right.
You know, like, you know, maybe, you know, they get a Babbitt or a Yacht or a Ryan Drost even, you know, to just get in his sight line so that he doesn't get a clean look into the end zone.
Yep.
You know, and furthermore, I want to say that as this game continues, all we're seeing is Ottawa getting more and more confidence. You know, the guys they have out here, these 18 guys, you know, they're missing their 7 guys at Worlds. And, you know, sometimes that makes the team bond a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, where they just, they're like, hey, it's us against the world.
Yep. Particularly when you're 2-6 on the year. Again, they, you know, you do almost play with your back against the wall, like, you know, almost underappreciated. You feel like, you know, people haven't seen your best so far, so you want to go out and prove that you can get a win without some of your better players.
They had those two kind of like drops early, and since then they've been very solid. This is going to hang up. Who's going to get there? It's caught. Brooks will put it deep. He's got a wide open man, and Ryan Holmes, sorry, Mike Drost, and it's a goal. Crowd has picked up a lot here, Dan, as they appreciate that. A lot of folks out here on the berm of the hill enjoying the shade to watch the game.
Yep. On that last play, Tony, a little bit of a mistake from Ottawa. When you have a 50-50 ball like that, particularly when the wind holds it up, and again, some funky things happen where the wind just holds it up long enough. And so for Ottawa, if you have a few guys disc watching and trying to get into that scrum, then you've got to make sure that the guys downfield are at least covered. And so whoever was on Mike Drost must have got into that scrum, so Drost just continued to guide down to where then everybody turned around and nobody was sure who Mike Drost is, who his man was.
Yep, a lucky break again for the New York Empire. But to win this game, they're going to have to get some more Ds. They got right back into this game to start the second quarter with a hold and two quick Ds and conversions, and then they let one go that should have been. They had two opportunities for another. As Boucher will check it in, guarded by Sam Taylor. Boucher centers it, Octolone.
Yeah, but Hill was going right up the middle looking for that first look by Boucher.
Hill will put this up to Ben Yacht. Yacht will get it. Too easy. Saw it from here. John Wodach with the disc now for the New York Empire. To Taylor Haskell. Haskell up to Ben Yacht. No one on him. Dross will make the streak deep. Yacht will put it. He'll hang it. This could be anyone's disc. Babbitt is trailing. Yacht will go up. Babbitt will go up. Everyone goes down, and the disc does as well.
I think Babbitt, again, he's a little frustrated, but to his credit, there were three guys between him and the disc, and he was the one who probably had the best read on it. He was the last one to jump, which in that instance, with the disc hanging in the air, gave him the best play on it, but there was just too many bodies in between him and the disc for him to get a full hand on it.
Unfortunate throw from Yacht there. He needed to put more zip on that. That hung way too easily for the defense to get there.
And we're noticing that there is just the disc seems to have plenty of air underneath it.
It's a little. It's the humidity is right. Part of that. Yeah.
Now, Ottawa should have a little bit of experience again down in D.C. That 2013 loss, as Dross gets the D there, an important one as New York could strike here.
Beautiful clean D there. Ryan Dross goes under, gets his man. They have to score this disc here. I'm thinking timeout if I'm C.J. Ouellette. Matt Lamar will lace it deep instead to Ben Yacht. Yacht with yards and height, and he gets the disc. Ben Yacht goes up big, spikes it down, and there's the first lead since early in the second quarter for the New York Empire here as Ben Yacht gets it from Matt Lamar.
By Yacht standards, he's been pretty quiet in this game, actually. Only one D and two goals and one assist, which, again, for a guy that even last week against the Phoenix, he, you know, absolutely exploded with four goals, two assists, and five Ds. And so today, as we have a timeout here, he's been a little quieter, but you're seeing now in the last about a minute of this third quarter that Ben Yacht, you see his big playability, and that's what he is. When you're a guy who's 6'5", and, you know, offensive player of the year at the collegiate level, playing in Minnesota, you know, he's a guy that can make changes.
My bad, Ryan.
Yeah, we should 1-3. Let's slow him down. If they start to take a lot of time, then you have to start pulling the wings back.
Can you actually take one for Tyler? Hey, Tyler!
I think there's two ways to open it. That's why it's confusing. All right, Tyler's the 1-3-1.
We're 1-3-3 for how many throws? We gotta wait for
the water. Just 1-3-3. Just if they get past half field, convert them to man like we're our normal 1-3-3.
Let's go, boys. I picked it up. What? Is it water? There it is. Right. Cold water.
Josh. Hey, there's 49 seconds and we have a timeout. So if we get a turn, I'll let you work with it, but if you're getting caught up, I'm going to call it, okay? So play hard. If you're tired after you get the D, we'll call a timeout. I'm just saying, play hard, and if you look tired with 20 seconds left, I might call.
Dan, listening in there to C.J. Ouellette, the coach, talking with Jeff Babbitt in the huddle there, and Wodak and some of the others. What do you think of his suggestions there on staying with the defense?
Yeah, so we saw three main points. The defense has worked. That 1-3-3 has worked. That's what helped him get back in the game, helped him take that 16-15 lead now. And, you know, as we've been talking about through this game, if they look gassed, if things aren't working, that they're going to take the timeout. And third and most importantly, Gatorade is an important part of the Empire's recipe, seemingly. You know, they're bringing it out there, get rehydrated. But in this kind of heat, though, it is important. You know, staying hydrated and staying. And he even said, if you look gassed, give all you can for the D. And if you don't get the D and you look tired, we will take a timeout. Yeah. You know, so the heat actually is, as we're hearing, playing an effect in this game.
Interesting. And you'd think that would be an advantage to the home team here with the numbers that they have.
Right.
And we'll see if that does play out in the fourth quarter. As Ottawa is receiving on O.
And even though the Empire do have the numbers, though, Tony, I've noticed both teams pretty much going 16-17 deep. And Ottawa is basically playing their entire bench today. And for the Empire, they're basically going with the same D-line we've seen.
I've seen most of their guys out there.
With one or two differences as well.
Yeah. Okay, so 49 seconds left here in the third quarter. It's centered up to Westwell. Westwell fakes. It's the 1-3 zone, as promised. Boucher with the disc. Drops it to, that's Russ Nichols. Nichols to Westwell. Westwell complaining to his team, looking for that swing to the sideline. It wasn't there, just the observer. The ref was there. It's an easy D for Wodach. An easy D for Jeff Wodach. Sorry, John Wodach. Wodach will pick it up. They've got 25 seconds, 24. The clock is ticking down. He wants to center to Aloro. Now he's got to look upfield. He's got Ryan Dross. He'll sling it deep instead for Jeff Babbitt. There's two defenders there. Yacht will go up big and get it! What a play. Ben Yacht rises up high, goes up early. And that's a quick turn of events. He goes over Octoroni for that one. As the Empire with a quick D from Wodach and the score from Ben Yacht to take the two-point lead.
Yacht is big, Yacht is young, and Yacht is tall. And he used all three of those skills that he has to get up to get that disc. And for Wodach, yeah, I think it was a high stall count. and probably an ill-advised throw. Babbitt was on the wrong side of the disc, the way the disc was coming in, and Yacht just read it perfectly. And more importantly, I think for Ottawa's side of things, that was Boucher's first turnover of the game as well.
Interesting, and a lazy throw up the line. He looked frustrated after. The whole team looked frustrated at that point there. So the frustration level has pivoted from the Empire to the Outlaws.
And these games are long. I mean, 12 minutes a quarter, and they go quickly. I guess when the weather is perfect and things are beautiful. But again, in this heat, these games can feel like a battle. And again, different. If you can be the last team to go on that run, you can get the W today.
So it's been a 9-3 quarter so far for the Empire. 8 seconds left. Boucher with the disc. He'll center it to Westwell. Westwell will put it. There's Babbitt and Yacht hanging out deep. Nichols will have to put it. Nichols will send it deep. This might go too far. Yacht is there instead. Both of them are there. It's a clean D. No one gets it. Yacht and Babbitt and Ross Ward collide for the D, and that will be the end of the quarter as Ottawa cannot connect on this point here.
Lizzo was actually pretty close to it. Lizzo got underneath Babbitt. So Lizzo, yeah, I think, had almost enough on it. And again, it's not Babbitt's fault for being as broad-shouldered.
Babbitt-sized.
Babbitt-sized, yes, being basically a brick wall. So I think when Lizzo jumped backwards and knocked into Babbitt, again, it's not a foul on Babbitt just because he's occupying that space. But I think physically, it's difficult to concentrate and catch that disc when you jump into a brick wall of Jeff Babbitt.
That's a funny way to put it. Right. Let's see what CJ says.
And they dropped it back like we expect them to do. Right. And then he was looking for the around, but the first one
he's
was
talking
covered,
to Haskell right now.
And
actually,
he made it sound like he was expecting another person coming to the far side. So my suspicion is that they're going to send somebody for that second foul one.
Yeah.
So it might be worth telling whoever is that guy in the back. We're
online. It's probably either Babbitt or John. Yeah. Okay. Hey, bring it in, guys.
So, Dan, we heard them talking about, I think it was about that zone defense and what they were looking for and how they were missing that side handler, and then he tried to get upfield with it, and they got the D.
Yeah, having a one-on-one conversation with Tyler Haskell that time.
Okay.
Haskell coming over, talking to CJ. And so, again, I think, speaking of that, they were speaking about the positioning of where Jeff Babbitt needs to be necessarily to get that D that John Wodatch did.
Gotcha.
I think that's what they were doing. They're actually breaking down the D that they got and to why that worked. And sometimes, Tony, that's the best thing to do. It's not necessarily what we need to do differently to get a D. It's when we did get a D, what did we do well? And sometimes, you're right, it's just a throwaway, but in other times it is doing something right.
Fuck yeah, John. Fuck yeah, D. Hey, guys. We're going to come back out here on defense, and we're going to keep it rolling, okay? We're gonna throw out the starting D. Go man, force them backhand. They have the win behind them, so we don't want to do that 1-3-3. If you want to throw a little 2-3-2 to take away any pull plays, that's fine, but hard man, force them backhand, okay? Hey, let's keep it up.
New York.
One more quarter.
A little fire, boys, a little fire.
Fourth quarter on three. 1, 2, 3.
Fourth quarter!
Okay, well, interesting. So, Dan, they're gonna go to man, it looks like.
Mm-hmm. And I think for leg-wise, while they have been playing similar numbers today, you have to remember, again, Ottawa's playing tomorrow and the Empire aren't. So the Empire know that you really can. You now
that's a good
play.
Point.
You are not, you have a number of days to take off.
Yeah.
Run them. You really, truly only have 12 minutes left. And, I know this is not what head coach CJ Gillette meant, but big picture is, realistically, they could only have 12 minutes left of the season that gets them into the postseason.
Yeah.
So you have to get a win here.
And Mandy, if your team is fresher than the others, is a good choice. I see what you're saying.
I mean, if you have some of the physical monsters you do, we beleaguer the point, but it's because, Jeff Babbitt on the season comes in with 28 Ds. Yacht comes in with 7 blocks in 2 games.
Yeah.
I mean, these are guys that make, they're difference makers on defense. And, Wodatch, Aloro, I would make an argument the Empire have one of the better defensive lines when everyone is out there and everyone is healthy, particularly in the East Division, but possibly in the whole league.
Yeah, they're one of the best defensive teams in the league. That's statistically and also passes the eye test, true.
Well, Empire have allowed 14 goals or fewer three times a season, most of any team in the AUDL.
Boucher, he's got an away man again. They've got to recognize this. Holmes will try to track it down for the D. Who will get there first? And Ottawa will score. It's Lizzo again going up in the air. Laurent Lizzo, is that going to be inbounds? I believe it was, right?
Yes. Yep. Now Boucher. We got 6 goals for Lizzo, and No surprise, the guy who threw that assist, number 5 for him in Nick Boucher.
I mean, we're up here in the booth. We can see this, but that play developed rather easily.
Yeah.
An away cut from Luzeau. Holmes a step behind. Boucher was given the forehand, the lefty forehand, and a score for Ottawa. And you know, they're going to lose this game if they don't recognize and stop that.
Yep. For Ottawa, we've seen so far, even with missing the players they were missing coming into this game, they're comfortable, particularly with Luzeau, going with one-on-one matchups. And that's always a big question. What guys on your team are you comfortable with going up one-on-one in traffic, and what guys are you going to, again, not necessarily throw one-on-one with a premier defender?
And Holmes is there, and Holmes is a very excellent defender.
Right.
Yep. And Luzeau just went up and did one better. So here's the offense, pressure on New York. Harper Garvey with the disc in their horizontal stack. Scoobers it up to Sam Little. Sam Little looking for Kotcher. Kotcher with the disc. Wanda Connor Klein deep, but holsters it and slings it over to Garvey. The out cut for Garvey wasn't there on time, so he goes through the middle to Connor Klein with the big scoober. Klein up to Little too low. The scoober too low for Ryan Drost. He can't get there, and the disc goes back to Ottawa's D-line.
The Empire, the scoobers were working, Tony, but I think they might have been getting a little too fancy and a little too comfortable with those throws over the top.
Mensah with the cut across the middle. Let's see where Ottawa... Oh, the man fell down, and there's a poach attempt for Mike Drost. Oh, he did it, and it tipped right to his defender, Khalid Al-Zalani. So Zalani picks it up after Drost tips the disc. The break goes to Ottawa. Can they convert? Nice pick off the dirt by Lemurel. This disc will hang. A chance for Mike Dross for another D. Against Alzeroni. Alzeroni reads it perfectly. Bodies his man out. Gets it to Mensah. Mensah looking. Drops it for Kentel. It's a goal for Ottawa. They have tied the game. Khalid Alzeroni with several huge plays. Fends off Mike Drost and is also able to get the collected tip disc, and Zarani showing up for Ottawa to tie the game.
And most impressively, Tony, the three players that we were talking about at the end of that play, Alzeroni got his first goal today, as we had talked about, and then Mensah, that's his first assist of the season, and then Kentel, his second goal of the day and second of the season. So those three guys, again, were three guys that, you know, looking at this game said, you know, if I want more playing time for the rest of the season, I've got to have a big game today. And those three guys are the three who had, you know, major factors in the point that ties it up at 17 all with 10:26 to go.
Well, here's where I want to go back to talking about the Ottawa Carleton Ultimate Association, OCUA, yep. Where they have they've had for years now the largest all seasons league of Ultimate in North America. They bought their own turf fields. They have a lot of players in Ottawa, and we're seeing a lot of talent come out of that system.
That's important for young players, just playing all year round. When it snows, especially in Canada, find ways to throw a disc.
Kotcher. Oh, Sam Little wide open. He holstered it. He had Connor Klein there, but a lot of times that throw hasn't been working for these guys, so they have to have this score. I don't mind them holding that one. Back to Kotcher. Keegan getting back into the mix, but Kotcher instead will find Connor Klein. I like these goal shots coming from a shorter distance, and that's what it looks like they're working to do here. Mataletta with the disc. Mataletta's had a great season. Kotcher always open. Kotcher will look to find the score. He's got Klein. There he is. There's the goal. Those two have connected for plenty of points here. Great patience from New York. Now, that's what you really want to see out of a team there. You know, the open shot there was the opportunity was there. Little to Klein, stringing to the goal, and he didn't throw that. And instead, they work it in for a 5-yard throw. So it's 18-17, New York Empire, 9:39 left in the fourth quarter here.
Yeah, still plenty of time for either team to find a way to take the upper hand in this game. But as we've been talking about throughout this third and fourth quarter, I think we're at a point in this contest where it's going to come down to the end. It's going to come down to a close game. And, you know, as players are missing throughout the season, particularly over the summer and these last few weeks of, you know, June, and then we'll see it in even the beginning of July when players are missing for different ultimate-related events, we see a lot of close games. And even with DC, we see the game that Ottawa, you know, defeated DC. And you know, that was a close game the whole way. It looked like D.C. was going to have their way with Ottawa. And then Ottawa kept it close, kept chipping away.
You mean Philly, right? You mean Philadelphia?
I mean Philly, excuse me, against Philadelphia.
That's right. They kind of won that at the end, right? It was a buzzer beater win for Ottawa.
Yep.
Boucher will send it deep. He's got his man. Holmes will try to track it down. It's to Lizeau again for the goal. When will they recognize? Well, recognize or not, Boucher and Lizeau are getting it done. All credit to those guys. That play has been working, and it's there. Might as well keep on doing it.
Yeah, Lizeau came in with 14 goals on the season. He has 7 alone in this game. So now 21
switch
on the
up.
Season.
Put some height on this. Get somebody on him. If New York wants to continue their season, they got to get Ryan Dross and Lizeau, and they got to put a body on Boucher, because right now what they're doing is not being effective.
Right. I mean, that's an interesting thing for both Babbitt and Yacht, where, you know, athletically they're tall, they're long, but as far as, you know, having them guard cutters downfield, you know, they're both very, very quick, but are they, you know, Lizeau quick? Are they quick enough to handle a guy that is, you know, he is a compact and speedy guy with a low center of gravity, and sometimes...
It doesn't matter. If he's going to score 7 goals, you put your best man on him.
Yeah.
I don't care. Like, you have to switch it up. And if it's like, if Babbitt is currently guarding Ochterlony, and then Ochterlony is going to start killing you, well, you know, then you pick your poison. But right now, Lizeau is their poison. Little with the disc. Mike Drost drops it back instead to Kotcher. Kotcher will around it to Brooks. Brooks pops it, but Keegan's there. Keegan will survey. Keegan will break the mark to Little. Little, Connor Klein try to get a hot cut out of it. No dice. Oh, through the middle. Kotcher to Keegan for the goal. Ping pong. Plinko into the end zone. Crowd is happy. New York holds. 19-18 for New York. 8.5 to go.
I want to go back, Tony, on that point, to the throw from Taylor Brooks to Keegan. As, you know, for younger players watching, you always say, your coaches seem to always say, swing the disc, swing the disc, swing the disc. And Taylor Brooks did not look over to see if Keegan was making that cut. But when you've been playing together for a few years now, as these two have, again, Keegan, the LI native, it played for the Empire in 2016, so he has only really been playing for the Empire with Taylor Brooks, should we say, who has been playing with the team since 2013. But those two guys have played together throughout the New York community for quite some time. And so before Brooks even saw Keegan making that cut, he released the swing, just knowing that the man is going to be there. And so that's why your coaches, for the younger players, are trying to instill in you, just trust your teammates to be making the proper cuts.
Yeah, and that's team fundamentals. Like, that is the cut you should be looking for. He did pop it up in the air a little bit, so I have a slight disagreement with your analysis, because it was not a very good throw, and he was lucky that there was no defender there.
Yeah, but we're talking decision-making, not necessarily
correct.
Execution.
Correct, gotcha. Okay, fair. Boucher gets it through the middle. Now he's guarded by Guerin. He'll put it up. Yacht will try to track it down. Yacht will go up early and over Ottolone, and he baits Ottolone, so the young guy gets one on the veteran. Ottolone claps his hand. Can't believe he got baited up in the air as Yacht closed in quickly. Alora will pick up the disc. Break opportunity for New York. And go through the middle to Babbitt. Babbitt looking for Yacht. Had him. Holsters takes his time and just drops it up cleanly to Alora. Alora fixed to Ross Ward. Alora back down to Wodach. Wodach, they are taking their time, that's for sure. He scoobers it to Alora. Alora, he's got Guerin. Guerin, nobody on him. Taking their time to Yacht. Yacht's open. This is an important point for New York. As you can tell, they're very patient on this one. Babbitt looking around through the middle, nice and easy, to Ross Ward. Back to Alora. Alora for Guerin. It's a goal! Guerin with the catch. Ian Guerin makes sure of it. Two hands, comes down with it for a huge break late in the game for New York Empire as they go up by 2.
Talk about guys getting their first goals of the season. For the Empire, they have something in Ian Guerin getting his first goal of the year at an important time, too.
That's his first goal. Ian Guerin is one of the franchise players here. He's been with this team forever.
2015 and 2016.
Almost forever. Did I say forever?
since 2015. That depends on how long your forever is. But yeah, he was an NYU product. And well, what his whole thing is, again, as we're seeing, he's the man who's been having to guard Boucher for most of this second half now. And yeah, so he, that's where Ian Guerin, particularly in that zone as well, he exerts so much energy defensively, and he's not necessarily a deep threat either. You know, one of the more height adverse guys on the field at any time, but he's a high energy guy that again comes up with a big goal. And for New York, they now have a 2-goal lead for the first time since that first half.
First quarter, indeed, yeah. Oh, quick pull play here from Ottawa. He's got an open man. It's tracked down, it's easily by Nichols. Nichols now with the disc. Nichols, he's got a lot of people. His man fell down, but he found the other guy. Alexander collects it. As it looked like that was going to the undercut there, 15, looks like it was going to, can't tell, but Alexander is there as Ottawa holds 2019. Really? One other thing about Ian Guerin, I'll just pop in real quick there. Did you see where he's from? You have it on your list there?
Ian Guerin, I have that he played his collegiate frisbee at NYU.
He's from Westland, Michigan.
Westland, Michigan.
Home of Discraft Discs. That's where they're made, in Westland, Michigan. I was like, so, you know, you grew up with Discraft. You must have been playing discs all your life. And he said, yeah, same town. Yeah, they're there. So if you ever see Westland on your frisbees, that's where it is. Central Michigan.
Now, Ian doesn't make them himself. You know, that's not
I think he might have been in the factory. It's not, everyone in Westland must work in that factory. Right. I'm sure it's huge.
Of course, we know that, you know, Midwest ultimate continuing to grow, continuing to be important. But it really has been between Carleton, Minnesota, Wisconsin. You know, you're talking about perennial powers year in and year out.
Notre Dame, another powerhouse.
As well, yep.
Sam Little to Kotcher. Kotcher picks it off the ground. Kotcher will sling this one deep to Mike Dross. Can he read it? Well, it's going too far. Got a wind gust there. Mike Dross came under a little bit. The disc sailed a little bit deep. You can feel the wind now.
Yeah, Kotcher, he completes 98% of his passes. He very rarely throws it away. So that, you could tell, was a good decision. The wind just took it at the last minute.
The wind did pick that up a little bit. And just the slightest in cut from Drost, and it sailed a little too far. Yep. Ottawa with the chance to break and tie it up. They'll send it deep. Kotcher will try to catch up, but he won't be able to. It's caught by 44. That's Owen Watt. Owen Watt centers it. Up to Lemaire. Lemaire will put it up for Mensah. It's a tie game. Ottawa will not go away. An excellent set of plays there. Three throws and they're into the end zone to tie this game up after the Kotcher overthrow to Drost. Dan Mensah, another one of your players here, showing up from the stat line for the first time.
Yeah, he had 5 goals coming in. He's got 1 today, along with that assist earlier in this half. But, you know, but he found himself wide open there, and so often that centering pass that comes, you know, as you talked about the hockey assist, that hockey assist that comes winds up being the most important pass.
Yeah. The crowd trying to cheer on the home team here as this one's locked up at 20s. We have an excellent game here for you. Ottawa pulls the disc. It's back to the O-line again, who failed last time. Let's see what they can do here as this disc will hang up and tail out of bounds. Sean Keegan will saunter up. They'll center it over to him. I'll let it next to him. Frank Wing downfield in a horizontal. Kotcher in the middle. Sam Little with him. Garvey to the side of Keegan. Who will he look for first?
If I had to put my money on Sean Kotcher, I think that's where I'd go.
Keegan to Kotcher underneath, or Keegan to Kotcher deep? Instead, it's Little. Little. Now Kotcher will set up his cut. Kotcher. Now he's got a streaker deep. Will he put it? No, he'll holster. He had 2 men go with it. Mensah went with him, but he couldn't find the open man. Drops instead to Little. Little takes the hammer. Had him there. They're running good, though.
Yeah, Ottawa's bringing the help over the top to Klein, so who's the open man?
You're right. The little poachy zone from Ottawa has been a little poachy player. Garvey. Patience from Garvey. Back to Kotcher. Back to Garvey. This is usually the spot where you get an open shot, and they do. Klein streaking to the sideline on the cross cuts. Garvey finds him with the backhand to the offhand. And they punch it in again. This game is a good one.
Klein with 8 goals. He had 17 coming into today. Now just 8 on the afternoon. Puts him at 25 for the season. So I don't know what it is about when, I mean, Ben Yacht coming over, I think, for Klein. They don't play on the same lines, but just sometimes in an influx of a new player or something new changing can really help a player work things out.
I think Connor Klein's having an excellent game.
Yeah.
This is a game of this is the type of game where you make a one mistake, you know, Kotcher overthrew Dross by a little bit and they made him pay. You know, at this point, you know, Boucher throws that turnover on the sideline that Wodach gets, they make him pay. So this is the game where everyone's playing well.
Yep.
And it's who's going to make the mistake and the other team is going to be there to capitalize.
Yeah, in terms of New York, it's getting to a point where it's a little higher scoring, 21-20. You know, very, very rarely does New York have both teams get into the 20s.
Boucher hung it. Yacht is there, but Boucher knew that he put too much air underneath it. Babbitt, there's a million people there. Babbitt will come up with it. As Boucher hung his head immediately after throwing that. Holmes, Yacht. Yacht looks for Babbitt. He puts it up there. It hangs up there. Babbitt's got nothing but space. Nobody on him, and it's a goal. Ben Yacht to Jeff Babbitt, bookends for the Babbitt. The rabbit, they call him. And that's a late break for New York with 5 minutes left in this fourth.
The 2016 College Offensive Player of the Year from Minnesota in Yacht to the 2016 College Defensive Player of the Year from UMass in Babbitt. For Babbitt, only his second goal of the day even. So where Babbitt's been important is just, again, being a big body, and he's the one that got the D, though. That's the more important thing. As you had mentioned earlier, it's not necessarily that he's, again, with just 2 goals, he doesn't necessarily need to have a big offensive contribution, but he's the guy that you trust that they throw up a 50-50 ball, and he is going to absolutely finish that.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And I wonder, you know, if it seemed like when Boucher let that disc go, sure, it hung up in the air, but even that disc was on a rope, I get the feeling there was going to be a few people there. Like, maybe they figured out that Boucher is going to send that one. He's got a green light.
Yeah.
And the defense jumped on it. Here's the pull for Empire coming down to Nick Boucher. Boucher centers it to Westwell. Westwell. It's a hose stack. He slides it over to side. It's a side stack, sorry. And back to Boucher from Ochtolone to Jeremy Hill. Jeremy Hill's had a great game today. Actually, all these guys have been pretty good today. Nichols. Boucher back to Nichols. Nichols. It's a forced forehand. Ryan Dross was trying to get there but couldn't. Back to Westwell, playing well. He sends it deep. He's got a man. Alaro tries. It's no good. It's too late. Instead, it's a goal for Carson Turner. As Westwell finds an open man, Alaro came under too much, gave him too much space. Unafraid, the Ottawa Outlaws put it deep.
So, Tony, a little question for you. You can probably guess the answer. For Carson Turner, what number goal was that for him on the season?
I'm going number one for the season.
He had 6 assists. That is goal number one for Carson Turner on the year. So another guy, another role player, another utility man, if you will, coming off the bench in the absence of all their stars and proving an impact.
In the ODL, these are the guys that are your practice players.
Right.
These are the guys that go to all your practices. Maybe they'll travel with you. And you can only roster 20 for a game, right?
Right.
So maybe they're on the roster as 24. Then you send 7 guys to France, and Derek Alexander can't make it to all your games, and you're going to get some playing time. So,
yep.
And if you make the most of it, that's what these guys are doing. 22-21 is your score. Empire, Keegan, centers to Garvey. Garvey surveys to Keegan. Connor Klein wants to go deep, and Keegan will put it for him. Connor Klein's got steps. He's holding it, and he gets it. He high points it. Is it a goal? They're saying no. Connor Klein thought so, but he'll check it in at the line and drops it back for Sam Little. Sam Little will take his time and gets it back to Connor Klein. A lot of enthusiasm there from New York. The crowd is loving it.
Connor Klein is playing with plenty of confidence today. You could tell a cutter when they're playing with confidence, the way they really just slither their way through a defense, and that's what Klein did. He thought he was in, he dumps it back, and even though Keegan was, we'll say, more wide open than Klein was, Klein said and knew that he was the guy who was going to get the disc. So he went about 4 feet back faked that he was going back into the stack and immediately turned on a dime and found himself wide open.
I just like his confidence and read of that disc because, you know, the defense was there.
Yeah.
And he high pointed that and made a great play. And, you know, when your team is holding a slim lead of one in the fourth quarter with your season kind of like hanging on the brink there, you know, those are the kind of plays you want to see your team make.
And for all the postseason times that the Empire have gotten there, they, with rookies in Yacht, well, not Yacht, excuse me, to the Empire, but the first year with the Empire, as well as Babbitt and Connor Klein being a rookie in the league, you know, the Empire, they're almost shifting their foundation, their core players a little bit. And so, again, they don't want to miss the postseason for the first time. But, you know, you're seeing Connor Klein as a rookie really coming into his own, particularly in this game.
A zone defensive look from the Empire. I like this call, Dan. Try to eat some clock up.
Yeah, up by two, especially if they get a break here. Go up by three for the first time since the first quarter.
Oh, a low throw from Lozeau, and it's down. And it's a turnover. Wodach will pick it up.
That's almost the first mistake we've seen Lozeau make all day.
Up to Lamar. No reason to rush this for New York. They have a two-goal lead late in the fourth. Sorry, not late in the fourth. Kind of-ish late in the fourth. I don't know what you want to call it. Drost. He's got Lamar behind him. Be smart with Drost. He centers it upfield. Nice give-and-go cut from Lamar. Lamar puts too much on it. Don't need that throw, Dan. Just don't need that look.
Right. I mean, they took about 48 seconds off, but you still mentioned there's still 3 minutes left. And, you know, now they're going to holster it.
And travel call. Yeah, so that looked like a nice clean call. But Boucher, it seemed to come in pretty fast, didn't it, Dan? Like,
yeah.
All of a sudden, Boucher is at the line at that turnover, zipping it deep. And I think this is a pretty good call. So this is a travel call on Nick Boucher.
That would have been a big catch from Hill.
Yeah, nice run from Hill, but that's going to come back.
Because that's the way you beat Drost, Yacht, and Babbitt, the three back there. You get them quickly.
Oh, but mistake from New York. They did not rush back to get to this.
Yep.
Boucher hit an easy check-in as while New York was just kind of lumbering back to the line. I don't know what they were doing, but Boucher now up to Forrest Knoll. Forrest Knoll centers it. New York looks slow. Boucher, Westwell. Octoloni over there. Octoloni fakes it.
Ottawa, you got to keep moving the disc.
Hammers it. Wide open man is
Boucher.
Is Boucher, of course. Not used to seeing receive the disc. This is a risky one. Ryan Drost is there, as is Babbitt. So a Yacht with the D. Boucher with an interesting choice there has the short field and instead slings it way over to the other side and is D'd up by the Empire. Up to Babbitt. Minute and change left. They just got to hold this disc. No use, no point in doing much else than that. And it's a timeout call. Let's hear what CJ Willett, coach of the Empire, has to say.
Starting O! Starting O!
I don't know, Dan. I think that's probably the call right there. Get the starting O
out.
That's
all you need to know, yeah. Garvey, Keegan, get your starting O out there. And, you know, with 1:32 left now, Tony, I think the umpire would be confident to say that if they scored here, they could put this one in the books. Being up by three, and the way this game is
weird, but
but the way this game has gone,
yeah.
You know, no team has been up by more than three since the first half.
Good point. Excellent point. And scores don't come in twos or threes. They come in ones.
Particularly how good the zone has been as well from the Empire. I mean, and the other thing is when you're down by numerous points, what is the key strategy, we'll say, and that's just to, you know, get it towards the end zone as quick as you can. But the Empire have Yacht, Babbitt, and Ryan Drost, so that strategy is almost nullified to a point to just rely on your hucks. So I think for Ottawa, you know, they're going to have to make sure they get almost a quick D here, because for the Empire, I mean, this offense, if they just continue to work it around, not turn it over, they can eat another minute off the clock plus.
That's clearly the one of the goals here for Ottawa. So you got to figure they're going to look at some crafty defenses here. You want to get a quick turn. You know who's done this excellently is any game between D.C. and New York.
Yeah.
If this was a D.C. game with a minute 32 and 23-21, guaranteed it's going to be a 23-23 game at the end of the regulation.
Yeah, absolutely.
Somehow, some way. It doesn't matter who has the disc. So let's see if they do anything crafty, Ottawa on D. Looks like they're just going to mark up man. Downfield is Jordan McGregor. On the mark over here is Jeff Bavon. Keegan with the disc for New York. He slings it over to Garvey, guarded by Cooper Brotman. Garvey got rid of it quickly. Nice defense from Brotman, but Garvey gets it. Garvey tries to find his positioning. Keegan streaks deep. They don't need that right now. They need this. Kotcher with the disc. Kotcher through the middle to Brooks. Brooks will sling it. I don't know why, but he's going to put it to Keegan and Connor Klein, and that's easily D'd up. 1 minute left to go here. Oh, wow. That's going to hold up there. And Ottawa's moving efficiently. 17, that's Bavon with the disc. Sadler with the disc. The crowd for New York is exhorting them to hold here as the clock is a friend. A big hammer. There's a call there, probably a timeout. That might have been a very good call from Ottawa. Let's see.
It appears that it is.
Yeah, excellent call there from Ottawa. They're going to get their O-line on the team, on the field. Just goes back to that throw. I don't know why, you know, we needed to see that from Brooks. Hook up field to double coverage, and it wasn't a great throw. Even if it was a good throw, I just don't. That's not the position on the field that throw needs to come from. The count wasn't high. It's a keep away sort of game.
Yeah.
Brooks isn't your elite hooker. He's not your Sean Keegan out there. And just a mistake there from Empire. But still, they've got a 2-point lead with 30 seconds here.
Yeah, and I think, again, that's the high risk, high reward, is that if that gets completed and you get it for the score, as we're seeing with the time, you know, that does basically put this one in the books, done and dusted, if they're able to get a score there. But again, as you've made clearly apparent, the truth of the matter is, the game could also be ending if you've gotten another, 30 more throws off, and then the clock just winds to zero.
Yeah, and then you score with 20 seconds left, maybe not. I don't know.
Either way, you're up by two,
yeah.
And it becomes a much more difficult task. But still, with 35 seconds left, you know, I'd say Ottawa's got about 15 seconds left to put this one in. You know, they have, I'd say it takes about 20 seconds, you know, for everything kind of set up to try to get a last-ditch effort. So, you know, in the next 15 seconds, they're going to want to try to get that score.
Ottolone with the disc, so you know he's got the hammer throw. I wouldn't be surprised if this is a right-away hammer cut. So that's a forehand. Wodach can't get there. Westwell through the center to Mr. Jeremy Hill. Collects another goal. That's a quick score, just what they needed for Ottawa. There's 26 seconds left. It's a 23-22 game. That's a lot of time. The pressure is on the New York Empire. Great job from Ottawa.
Yeah, even faster than, you know, we had, I guess, prophesized. And for 20, and with 26 seconds left, if you're New York, you see their O-line getting out there, you're going to think that if you're Ottawa, how many men do you bring down to this disc?
Crowd again telling them to play short and sweet, protect the disc, all the things that you hope they do. And let's see.
I think at this point, if Keegan or Garvey picks up the disc, I think you run your offense straight up the middle through Kotcher. Just continue to let Kotcher get open for 26 seconds, and the game has come to an end.
26 seconds is a lot of time. Sam Little.
Indeed.
Brooks still on the field. Brooks taking his time up to Keegan. Keegan, Little. Little looking, no one's cutting. Keegan, back to Keegan. They're sending Westwell around. They're switching him around. Drost will come and get it. Sam Little, 7 seconds now. This could work for the Empire as their season will stay around. Ottawa will give it up. Not enough time left, and the Empire will hold on for the 23-22 victory. A thrilling one here in New York City. What a game of back and forth, Dan. I got to say, that was a fun one to call and a fun one to watch.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there were different times. The best games, Tony, you think, in the AUDL are the ones where momentum shifts back and forth numerous times, and that's exactly what we saw, where particularly from that first to the second quarter, watching Ottawa completely take a stranglehold on the game. They went up by 4, and they looked like, you know, the Empire was on their last leg, and, you know, their season could have been coming to an end, but instead, and the Empire seemed to have some new breath coming into that second half. They tied it up quickly, then we went back and forth until mistakes by Ottawa late in that fourth quarter wound up being the difference. And the D-line for the Empire, where, you know, midweek head coach CJ Ouellette had said, you know, our D-line, we put a lot of pressure on them, those guys, to get Ds, get turnovers, and get breaks. And that's exactly what they did to help the Empire get the victory.
Yeah, the D-line really coming out strong to start that second half there in the third quarter. And then I'll give you know, both ways, because I'll say their offense really then kind of held the line for them.
Yeah, and really impressive by Ottawa, too. I mean, a lot of credit goes to them coming in with the guys. We'd even put the list of the guys who were missing and all the points. And, you know,
no, we can list them right now.
The final stat that we have is that with the guys who were at the Beach National, excuse me, the Worlds right now over in France, it was a total point total between goals and assists of 201 points were missing. They only had 158 points here today,
yeah,
already coming into this game. And so we saw so many guys get their first goals, their first assists for Ottawa. So a lot of credit for those guys showing their depth in a hard-fought game against the Empire. And, you know, this is the kind of team that Philadelphia is going to have to watch this one and prepare, because Ottawa's playing really well going into that game tomorrow.
It's going to be interesting to see what kind of legs Ottawa has left for their game tomorrow against Philadelphia, as you say. Now they're doing a nice little routine here where they like give a throw some disc into the stand. Dan, this one's for you. Can you get it? A signed Empire disc comes into the stand. Here's another black signed Empire disc. Last home game of the season. Ben Yat will throw this one up. Always fun. Dan, you ever gotten one of these discs?
I have not. I keep it professional. Stick to my place.
You don't
on
even
the side
try.
Line
is what you're saying? He's gonna throw one over to the berm side, and those folks are almost caught. Well, for all of us here on our production crew, which is myself, Dan Hilton, and Josh Braunrother, we thank you for watching, and for the whole season here. Home field in New York, the New York Empire. They finish with, I believe, a winning record here at home, 4-3,
yeah,
7 games. They stand right now at 5-6. So you want to hope they would have maybe ended this game on a stronger note.
4-5. They're 4-5 on the season. Yep.
4-5. Big doubleheader coming up next weekend,
yep,
where they go to Canada and they play Ottawa first and then Montreal. They win both those games. They will be in third place. So season's still around there for New York. They're in the playoff hunt.
So it really does come down to Montreal, as you mentioned. Montreal have 3 games left, as opposed to the Empire, who now have 5 games left. So they really do. They don't control their own destiny, but Montreal, with their 3 games, they have a home game against New York. They're away for the Rush, and then they're home for Ottawa. So it really could be this Outlaw team. If New York is able to take care of business against Montreal, it could be this Outlaw team on week 17, the final week of the season. If they take care of business against Montreal, they could be the team that helps the Empire, and we do say sneak and back their way into the playoffs as,
yeah,
much as they could. So for the Empire, their legacy, I mean, not legacy, but their you know, their trip to the postseason really does rest on how well Montreal does. And if they lose to Montreal, of course, then it's easily done and dusted.
Very difficult.
That's it
for them.
Right. Well, impossible, honestly.
Well, thanks again, everyone, for following along. And hope you had an enjoyable game. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. Beautiful here in New York at 80 degrees. And we will tune in for more AUD action next week. Signing off, Tony Leonardo and
Dan Hilton.
Thanks again, guys.